Okay, we will call the meeting to order. This is the April 17th meeting of the Yellow Springs Village Council. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes, Wintrow.
Here.
Houch.
Here.
Sims.
Here.
McQueen.
Here.
Hemphling.
Here.
Also present are Village Solicitor Chris Connor, Village Manager Patty Bates, and Melissa Van Zant is out on family leave this evening. I think that's everybody. Mayor Fobert is also present.
Interim Chief Carlson.
That guy, the big guy in the back, I'm so sorry. Interim Chief Carlson is also... I am paying him back, actually, yes.
So I think we have a... Well, are we going to do announcements first? Okay, we've got announcements first. Okay, I've got a couple. First, we've got Shred It, Yellow Springs, this Saturday, from 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. It's being sponsored by the Yellow Springs Chamber. It's in the parking lot at Limestone and Corey. So it's the parking lot right next to the Children's Center. So you can come in one way, drop off your stuff, and go out the other way. So that will be all of... It's past tax time. I know everybody's filed their taxes, and they can get rid of all that paperwork. Another event... Well, you know, the receipts, whatever. Then on April 20th, that's Thursday, April 20th at 6 o'clock, there is Home Inc. is hosting an event at the library. It's called Power to the People, Financial Empowerment and the Cost of Housing. 6 p.m. Yellow Springs Library, and they're going to be discussing, it's a free workshop designed to provide information to answer various questions about mortgages, foreclosures, affordable housing, and more. So that's Home Inc. Thursday night at the library, and I think that's it for me.
All right, I have a few. So I did want to mention that the Buckeye Trail Fest is happening in Yellow Springs, and we actually have an invitation on our table, but Yellow Springs will be designated as a Buckeye Trail town. And that ceremony is going to be on April 27th at 5 p.m. at the Yellow Springs Station. So join us for that. I also wanted to mention that one of my favorite musicals, Oklahoma, is coming to Yellow Springs. Yeah, actually, I was in Oklahoma. I was Andrew Carnes. And so I'm really excited, but that's going to be this weekend and next weekend, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. So I encourage people to go out for that. Also on, I guess it's this Saturday as well, is the hip-hop parkour jam from 10 a.m. to noon. So if you don't know about parkour, I would definitely suggest you check it out. We've got somebody famous coming into town, and he's going to be working with our students right out here at the skate park. Also, on April 20th, I wanted to mention that I just noticed that the Miami Township Fire and Rescue is having a public forum about their upcoming levy. So I know a lot of people are not so familiar about the issues around why this is on the ballot. So I would strongly suggest that if you aren't informed that you go, that's going to be at the fire station at 7 p.m. And I think that's all I need to announce for today.
Yep. Anything else, Council? Okay, we have a special swearing in. I see our mayor is here, so that means we have a village staff person being sworn in. Brian, would you like to introduce?
Sure. We are very pleased to announce Mariah England as a new peace officer in Yellow Springs. She'll be employed full-time, starts training February 26th, and we're really proud she's part of the team. Mr. Mayor?
Okay. Well, Mariah, welcome, and we're glad to have you here in Yellow Springs.
Sorry
look,
to hear.
Look forward to many years of service.
Okay.
And at this point, let's swear you in.
Okay.
Okay? And if you'll repeat after me. I, Mariah D. England.
I, Mariah D. England.
Solemnly swear.
Solemnly swear.
That I will support the Constitution.
That I will support the Constitution.
And I will obey the laws of the United States.
And I will obey the laws of the United States.
And of the state of Ohio.
And the state of Ohio.
And that I will in all respects.
That I will in all respects.
Observe the provisions
Observe the provisions.
Of the charter and ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs.
Of the charter and ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs.
And will faithfully discharge.
And will faithfully discharge.
The duties of the office of peace officer.
The duties of the office of the peace officer.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Family, thanks for being here. We'll take good care of her. We'll make her feel welcome and.
All right.
Bye. Welcome. Thank you. Welcome.
Thank you.
Uh-huh.
Wow.
We have, I think, at least one. Oh, we have two other swearings in. We have Deanna Newsom, and are you both on Environmental Commission? And Bettina?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I mean, you guys could potentially do it together. You know?
We're here to do us.
You guys can actually read your own. And you could do it a duet if you'd like.
That's what was.
And we should have asked Bettina to bring her.
My harp.
Your harp to.
Okay. Shall we?
We shall.
I solemnly affirm that I will support the Constitution and will obey the laws of the United States and the state of Ohio, that I will, in all respects, observe the provisions of the charter and ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs and will faithfully discharge the duties of the Office of the Environmental Commission.
Great. Welcome. Thank you. Bettina, I mean, you've been so involved, Bettina, in the project at Glass Farm that it's about time that we got you on the commission. So, and Deanna's been involved with a couple of the bicycling efforts and safe routes to school. So it's great to see her involved in a commission. Thank you both very much. You're welcome to stay or you're welcome to go.
Thanks.
Next, we have the consent agenda. We have the minutes of the April 3rd meeting and the financials for March. I think that, Judy, did you send the corrected minutes to, or just to me?
To you, to Marianne, and I'm not sure if I sent as well to
okay.
Brian.
There were a couple of what it was, I would consider typos that I don't think we need to review, but on page 6, in the discussion about the mining situation, I think it was down about paragraph 5 or 6, the paragraph starts, council members discussed the letter, which is the letter that I wrote, but there had been no previous mention of the letter. So I thought we should add the sentence, President Karen Wintrow introduced a letter she had written anticipating discussion on the matter. Let's see, there was one other, I think. Was there one other that was more significant?
The amount of the grant, or
okay.
The amount of the contribution, yes.
The amount of the contribution from Green County Parks and Trails was $25,000, not $35,000.
Yeah.
And did we change the language related to when it was donated, or?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And do you remember what that was? I don't remember what it
was. You just said in response to
a request. By Krista McGaw and Brian Hausch.
Yes.
So we got that in there that you both went and made the request. And so those were the minor changes that were made.
Okay.
Do we have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Next is a review of the agenda. Is there anything we want to add or move around on the agenda?
I have a question from last meeting, and I'm not finding it in the minutes now, but oh, okay, it was in the U.S. Bank proposal. It said that we had requested it, that staff put out an RFP for looking at other financial institutions. It's in the minutes, so I'd like to revisit that tonight because I want to suggest we not bother.
Okay, and I did get a letter. There was a letter on my desk that hadn't been opened from U.S. Bank, so we can either decide to read it. I don't like to do that. I think we should just have it in the next packet if that's okay with everybody.
Melissa will be back at the next meeting.
Okay, so we'll save all of that for the next meeting, the bank, this stuff. Okay.
Sounds good. Brian, would you please review the petitions and communications?
Yes. So we included the letter written by our village solicitor about the David Carlson case, which emphasized that the village is not looking for any restitution, and also referenced the letter that council sent about how we had also hoped that all charges were dismissed. Moya Shea wrote a very nice letter talking about the walkability success that our village crew created on the Dayton Street sidewalk. There was a patch that was badly damaged. We had several letters in support of Chief Carlson as doing a great job and that we should select him for our permanent chief. Those included Anita and Michael Brown, Tony Stratton, Beth Bridgman, Mary Beth Burkholder and Gary Zaremski, Libby and Dan Rudolph, and Carol Allen. And also there was a last-minute letter from Mikasa Sims talking about how kid-friendly Chief Carlson was, and she referenced a field trip they recently had that sounded like a lot of fun. They got a police escort. The Greene County Public Health provided us with two documents, one of them about the fact that overdoses are on the rise again, and it mentioned that when parents talk to their children about drugs and their dangers, that they're 50% less likely to use drugs. So that was important.
Can I do the hand motion?
Yes. Okay. And also there was a letter about distracted driving, texting, calling, and a current campaign by the Safe Coalition's council, who are a coalition who are trying to put out the word that, you know, when we text in particular, it's very likely that bad things are going to happen on the road. And we also had the mayor's monthly report. So, Karen?
There was a letter, I don't know how many of you know, that Dayton Hamvention is actually going to be in Greene County this year. It's going to be at the fairgrounds, Xenia Greene County Fairgrounds, May 19th to the 21st. They're expecting 20 to 30,000 people. That's a lot of people to get to that location, to stay in the region, and just to get around over a three-day period. So, Brian, have you been contacted by Xenia Police? I mean, I'm wondering if they might not want some backup at some point for traffic. But I guess what I would say is, during those days, if you don't have to go to Xenia on 68, I would stay completely away from Xenia on 68. Actually, probably any 10 miles around. Young's is actually a parking lot. They're doing a lot of remote parking to keep the cars out of Xenia. So Young's is a remote parking lot, so there will be a lot of buses going through Yellow Springs, taking people there. So we're definitely hoping that that we will see some financial benefit from, I know that a lot of people are staying in the hotel, hopefully some of the other B&Bs, and that they will be spending some money in Yellow Springs. But it's a great thing for the county. It's a huge economic boon for the county and for our hotels and for all of our hospitality locations. So just be aware of that.
Do you want to say briefly what it is?
Hamvention is it's ham radio. I just assume people know. It's been going on for so long in Dayton. It's basically ham radio aficionados, and these guys are the people that have headed it up. It's an international show, so people are coming from all over the world, but the people that coordinate it are local. They're local to Greene County, so that's one of the reasons it ended up in Greene County. It had been at Hare Arena in Dayton for years, and they that facility was closed and I think is maybe demolished by now, so they had to find a place to move it. So it's a real boon to us that to Greene County that they moved it here. So, and these are all, you know, these are people with lots of money and lots of disposable income, because it's apparently a very expensive habit to have, to like those ham radios, so.
And I also saw that they were willing to pass out coupons from restaurants, as long as they got them by May 17th.
Right, yeah. Let's see, what else? And then also, I found this, this came across my email today from the Ohio CDC that I think we're going to be, I have a feeling we're going to be doing a lot of this over the next 4 years, writing letters to our members of Congress for programs that are being cut. And this one is the CDBG program and another home program. So I was just home investment partnership. It's all about affordable housing, and we've actually benefited from CDBG money for our sidewalk ramps, our handicap ramps, and a lot of communities. We don't benefit from a lot of CDBG funding because it's typically for lower income, poorer communities, but a lot of communities in Ohio have benefited. So I think they've got a kind of a boilerplate letter. I was just going to ask council if it was okay if I sent these letters to Portman. It's to Portman, Brown, and Mike Turner. And I, like I said, I expect we're going to be doing more and more of that, unfortunately. So next is public hearings and
Karen, I have one thing.
Sure.
The letter that got in late about the first graders. It appears that our interim chief has been making quite an impression on our young people, first graders, and happened to be my daughter's class. And she said when they saw him, that they were cheering and so forth. And Brian stopped what he was doing and came up to the kids and so forth. And she called me that night to say, how the kids were really touched by just seeing him.
Oh.
So that does say that we are making changes in the community as it relates to policing.
That's good. Yeah, it's better that they're cheering and not running in fear.
Well, I gave out some 911 junior badges.
Thanks.
And one of the little kids decided that they felt the authority to call 911.
Really early in the morning.
It happened to be somebody sitting at this table.
Asked if he could change that to 922 or anything.
And what was the reason? I mean, the reason was, I think, something about that the dog was shedding.
she had dandruff. It wasn't just shedding, Karen, it was dandruff. He said, we either need a new dog or call 911. Apparently, they decided to.
And I also do have one letter that came in late today. Came through Chief Carlson from a resident who expressed her gratitude for the service that she received from the department. Last weekend, there were several intoxicated subjects enjoying themselves on the roof of one of the downtown buildings, and she lives in an apartment next door to that. So the officer went over and asked the party to go inside, which it did, but subsequently she apparently had a window broken out, which frightened her quite a bit. And officer, this is Mark Charles, I assume, Officer Mark Charles responded and assured her that she would be all right and sent the subject on home. So she sent a letter expressing her appreciation for the way he handled the situation.
That's great.
Yeah, she said he somehow popped out of nowhere and ordered the men howling at the moon back to their den. And then he assured her that he would stay in the area, which he did, and I was really proud.
Yeah. And I do want to thank citizens for communicating with us, whether it's good or bad. That's how we know how you're feeling about our services and the decisions we're making. So it's nice to get positive feedback, too. So we really appreciate it. Are we ready for legislation? Okay. Second reading and public hearing of Ordinance 2017-05, title only, Judy.
Ah. Oh. You want me to do it?
Yeah.
Repealing Section 1248.03, Spatial Requirements of the Codified Ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new Section 1248.03, Spatial Requirements.
Thank you. Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. And it looks like Denise isn't here. Patty's going to handle this one?
Yes, I have an email from Denise, and I'm just going to read it, if that's okay. Regarding the text amendment to spatial requirements, this change was brought to the Planning Commission by the BZA due to two variance hearings in which the property had met all of the setback, lot coverage, and parking requirements, but did not meet the square footage minimum, per unit minimum requirement. The consensus of both the BZA and the Planning Commission was because there are no minimum requirements in the zoning code for the size of a dwelling unit. By following the setback and lot coverage requirements in addition to parking and landscape screening requirements, the square foot minimum, square feet minimum property requirement for a two-family and/or attached single-family unit becomes insignificant, as the other requirements in the zoning code will dictate the density up to the maximum allowed in each residential district. To give you an example, the one property on High Street would have required 8,000 square feet, 4,000 square feet for each of the units, for a two-family dwelling, but the land wasn't even large enough to cover, to allow that. So this way, they don't have to abide by a minimum square footage for the actual dwelling unit, as long as it meets the setback, lot coverage, and yard requirements.
Okay.
It allows them to build a smaller unit on their property.
Okay. Any comments or questions from citizens? Jerry or Judith, do you have any comments from Planning Commission?
No.
Any other council members? This is a second reading, so I will open the public hearing for comment from citizens. Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to council table. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. Sims?
Yes.
Hemsley?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes. Next reading, next is first reading of ordinance 2017-09, title only.
All right. This is repealing section 674.02, removal of plants and weeds by owner of the codified ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new section 674.02, removal of plants and weeds by owner.
Thank you. Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. So this is one that we was on our agenda last time. We decided to table it because getting input from Nick Budis especially, I believe, and some citizens that it wasn't quite ready. So I think part of what's happened is that we've added some invasives and we've added a height requirement for the grass. But I guess I'll turn it over to Patty and let her do a broader review of this.
Right. Nick sent us an expanded list of invasives, and so what we did was we took the invasives that were suggested by the Environmental Commission and we added Nick's to that and made one. It's quite a bit larger list, but these are all considered invasive plants that we really don't want people planting. And
part of it was making sure that they're more relevant to our area.
Making sure they're more relevant to our area. So Nick did send me late this afternoon a couple of just corrections. He would like us to put the scientific names, of some of the plants that we missed on there, so that there can't be any confusion, because a lot of times one plant has more than one common name.
Mm-hmm.
The height requirement before was 12 inches, and this is back to 9 inches, which is what was discussed at council. And it also has a provision that says if you are not planting a managed natural landscape, you have to mow your entire lawn. So if you're planting a managed natural landscape, you have to mow the perimeter, which is indicated, below the managed natural landscape section. If you're having a grass lawn and you're not planting a managed natural landscape by the definition of this ordinance, then you have to cut your entire property. And a managed natural landscape can be a natural grass. It just can't be these invasive species. And I believe that those were the corrections that council had asked for at the last meeting.
Any comments or questions, council?
I just noticed, this is a typographical thing, but on number 6, inches got deleted after 9.
Oh,
yeah. And I think it should be in there.
Okay, hold on a second.
Oh, yeah.
All right, I got it.
There's also a period after growth that should come out of there, but, I mean, once you accept the changes, I think it'll be clear.
Mary Ann?
Yeah, I'm comfortable with the changes, but I'm wondering how people are going to know just from these names whether they have an invasive species in their yard. That's one question I have, and I don't know if maybe if anyone here knows, maybe Patty. The second question is, are there any of these invasives that are actually being sold that people would be, I mean, that they'd actually be buying?
Yeah, some of these things, you can buy them at Lowe's or Home Depot, yes.
So how could we have information available to people so they actually know what this stuff is? Otherwise, it's just names.
But didn't you say we were going to get pictures?
Well, Nick said that there were pictures available on the Ohio website, but...
Yeah, OSU has an incredible department that has a lot of these invasives on it, and you can look at the pictures and that kind of thing. As far as educational material, maybe that's something that Environmental Commission could work on, or, you know, maybe we could work in cooperation with Glenn Helen to find that information and have it available here at the Bryan Center for someone who...
Yeah, just create a brochure, a sheet with the pictures and the names.
Can we put a link to those photos on the website? Because I feel like this is also something that is worth highlighting on the website, since it's taken a couple years to sort of get it together. And maybe even we post it on the Facebook page, too, with that link.
Mm-hmm. How is this going to be enforced?
It will be enforced like all of our other, unfortunately, like all of our other zoning code violations or ordinance violations. If someone complains about it, we'll have to go out and look at it. There's a procedure where we notify the property owner of what the alleged violation is and ask them to remediate it within a certain period of time. And if they don't, then we take certain steps to remediate it and unfortunately have to charge them for whatever we have into it.
What did we decide about the large grassy areas that may be abutting someone's
I think it
home?
Says that someone, if their neighbors are okay, they don't have to mow. I think that says in the ordinance.
I believe there is an allowance for that in there, yes. It's on the, it's only on the side yards, though. I'm trying to find. It's in section 5.
Abutting property owners may agree to waive this requirement.
Right. That's only on the, and the reason it's only on the sides is because the front one, the section that abuts the road, it's necessary to have that moved back for visibility, backing in and out of driveways. So that's more of a safety requirement. But if the abutting property owners agree, then they don't have to move the perimeters.
Okay. Any other questions or comments? Questions or comments from citizens? This is a first reading, so we will have another. Dan?
I caught part of this discussion last time, and I guess I wanted to preface this that I didn't hear, I got here a little late and didn't get the very beginning of it. So there may be an answer to one of the questions that comes to mind, but reading through the revised legislation for this. I guess my question's a little bit different. Rather than how, it's sort of a why is this being considered as a legislative measure at this point, rather than an educational measure, for instance. And the reason I would say that is probably a different sense of the impression that the general public that I encounter has about the sort of appearance of the village, the disposition of people's yards and properties and that sort of thing. I'm guessing what prompts this is probably disputes that have been difficult to resolve between neighbors, where a neighbor has what is perceived to be an out-of-control lawn That is an irritant to somebody who lives next door or across the street, that sort of thing. And that's, I guess, a real concern for the people that are involved in, although I don't know if legislation and regulation is always the best way to enforce that. But in my experience with the village, and it's been for some time, and this has been both with people who live here and people who visit, that we often get flattered as a village for looking a bit different than the average suburb, which includes being a bit rustic and a bit unkept in some ways with the way that people handle their yards and properties and do some unusual things with them. I'd hate to see us sort of solve a sort of neighborly dispute problem with a broad bit of legislation that makes us look like an average suburb anywhere. Maybe I'm overstating that a little.
Personally, I think that's exactly what this does, because this really supports and encourages alternate kind of natural habitats and natural plantings as opposed to grass. So, and I think Patty does get a lot of phone calls. The village does get phone calls. There's rodents, there's snakes, there's critter problems that are created. It's just been an issue.
It has been an issue, but we have legislation now.
Right.
And this is simply a revision of the legislation that we have, and it actually allows more for a managed natural landscape than the previous legislation did.
May I just notice some of the one particular piece of language, and it's perhaps not referring directly to lawns, but it's a provision that I believe I picked up in there that speaks about not allowing plants to go to seed. And actually, cutting lawns short enough themselves so they never go to seed actually makes them harder to maintain, for instance. So. I mean, there could be kind of anti-sustainable, unintended.
That's related to the perimeter. That's only the median.
Okay.
And there is an issue with invasives. The Glen fights it. There is an issue with invasives. So I think also educating people about invasive species, discouraging that use, is protective of the environment, the natural environment in the Glen.
I think the people in the Glen do a good job with organizing their membership and doing public education that goes beyond that. And I guess, my thought was that, that the educational route is preferable to a legislative route that requires an enforcement mechanism for the community. That it might be, maybe less is more sometimes. That's the thing I wanted to put forward with respect to this.
Thanks, Dan.
Okay, thanks.
Any other comments or questions?
This is super quick. Kate Hamilton. One of the sections to protect the nesting habitat of wildlife, Division A2 of the section, shall not be in effect from April 1st to July 1st of each year.
Can you speak up, Kate?
Was marked off. That's about as loud as I get right now. Do you know the one I'm referring to?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
I was curious why that is taken off of there and if it's reflected anywhere else within here.
Actually, it doesn't really. If we're talking about people who are strictly cutting their grass, we're not talking about managed natural landscapes, which you can actually have more of, then the habitat that we're asking people to cut, it's not nesting habitat anyway.
Okay.
And so that's why that particular part was removed.
It was redundant, basically, in a sense, or it wasn't?
It was not redundant. It was, it didn't really have any effect on the people who, they weren't cutting their grass because they weren't being told to cut their grass until July. Nothing was nesting in it. But this still allows for them to nest in the managed natural landscapes throughout the village, just like they always have.
Okay, great. And my other suggestion when you firm this all up is that I know a lot of people are not on electronics and things like that. It would be nice to have pictures of things and this at the library for people to access. It would be helpful.
Yeah, maybe that's a little project we can work on with the Glen. I mean, I'm even thinking that they might have invasive, something on invasives on their website somewhere, so maybe that's something we could work with them on.
Well, Nick provided us with a link to all of his.
Okay.
So we can just take that link.
And new homeowners, too. I don't know, you do a basket at the Chamber, don't you, for new homeowners?
No.
Kind of, you don't?
Nope.
I feel like you did, but maybe something that we give to new homeowners so they have, like, you know, because you spend a lot of money on landscaping, and if it doesn't fit in.
Yeah.
Right.
You gotta tear it all out, so, just.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of common stuff on here, so I know people are buying a lot of this stuff.
I've been ripping honeysuckle out for years.
Yeah. Any other comments or questions? Judy, would you call the roll, please?
Yes, Hausch.
Yes.
Hempfling.
No.
Sims.
Yes.
McQueen.
Yes.
Quintrow.
Yes. Finally, we have Resolution 2017-20, and please read this in full.
Yes, this is declaring April 27th, 2017, Coretta Scott King Day in the Village of Yellow Springs. Whereas Coretta Scott King's lifelong legacy was to ensure that all those affected by injustice would one day find their voice, and whereas Mrs. King sparked her social justice flame while attending Antioch College, and whereas equality for all for all became her daily mission, a mission that led Mrs. King to lend her name to Antioch College for the development of the Coretta Scott King Center, and whereas the vision of the Coretta Scott King Center is to transform lives, the nation, and the world by cultivating change agents, collaborating with communities, and fostering networks to advance human rights and social justice, now therefore be it resolved that, Section 1, April 27th shall be recognized as Coretta Scott King Day in Yellow Springs and is intended as a day of collaboration, commemoration, and recognition for those striving every day for Mrs. King's lifelong dream of equality for all.
Thank you. Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. I mean, this is great. I do know that there is also an event commemorating Mrs. King on the Wednesday, April 26th, down in Dayton. So it's nice timing, and it's great that we're finally doing this.
Will there be anything in Yellow Springs? Do you know?
There is something at Antioch. Here. On the
24th, I think we got an invitation.
24th, I believe.
Yeah, that's the one in Dayton.
That's the Rocket Club.
I had an email earlier today, but it's going to take me a minute to find it.
And I would like, I mean, I guess Brian could possibly do this, but to do something, make sure our Facebook page is, that's posted on our Facebook page.
Yep.
Hopefully we can find a nice picture, and actually if there was a way to even put the resolution, I think that would be nice. Well, why don't we move on? Yeah. I mean, if you can find it maybe by the end of the meeting.
Yeah, it's just going to take me a minute.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Okay, thank you. Now is the time in the agenda.
Oh. I just noticed there were a couple people here probably for that other ordinance that we took off the agenda. I thought maybe we should. The short-term rental, ordinance that had to do with short-term rentals was taken off the agenda. And just to say that Matt, or Brian and I met with Matt Reed, who's the head of Planning Commission, and Denise, and just talked with him. We were looking at another kind of problem communities that are destination communities are having with Airbnbs, where there's which is a little different than what we were talking about with that last piece of legislation, where, for example, small homes that could be starter homes become Airbnbs, and the whole issue of affordability, you know, the affordable housing starts to get eaten up in that way. So we would like to address, so we were talking about how to address that problem versus, you know, the homeowner that may be renting a room in their home, which is a different kind of an issue. So it will be coming back, but I know Matt thought it would be going back to planning a commission again, I think. Didn't he?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So we had initially had
We took it off the agenda because I could see that you were sitting here because of
Thank you.
I think you and Eric were both there, yeah.
But you're not suggesting that it's not going to be
revisited? It's going to come
revisited.
Back. It's going to come back.
Okay. Because I think that it's something that I...
It's going to come back in a different form.
And an important issue.
Okay.
There is an event for, at the Cora Scott King Center in Antioch on Tuesday, the 25th. Unfortunately, the email that I was sent does not list a time for that, so I'm trying to look it up.
There might be something on Antioch's website. Okay. Thanks, Louise. Okay, so now's the time in the agenda for items that are not on the agenda. To hear from citizens, we ask that you come to the microphone and state your name and keep your remarks to 3 minutes.
Hi, Kate Anderson. I hope you've been enjoying the wonderful weather we've had lately. I think it's been really terrific and lovely here in particular. Because of that lovely weather, I think the annual migration to Yellow Springs has begun. And so I know you're probably aware there's a lot of grumbling about what's happening on weekends here and access to things. And so I would like to just put it out there, especially to Chief Carlson, I want to speak to you about it, is we're working so hard on safety and visibility and other issues like that in town that on the weekends that seems to disappear. If you sit downtown midday on a Saturday in particular, and you watch behavior of our visitors, it's pretty appalling. So I'm concerned that if we don't do something about this, citizens who live here and pay the taxes and expect certain services, we're becoming a little more disgruntled than usual, I think, from what I hear. So I do recall a time, I've lived here long enough now to remember when tires were chalked and parking regulations were enforced and people were asked to, in a good way, because we've always done things in a good way, to behave, respect when they're here, respect us when we're here. I see crosswalk stuff going on where people are almost hit because of traffic and the nonsense, let alone just trying to access anything here on a, I made the mistake Saturday of saying, oh, I got to run to Tom's for something. Oh, my God, there's no place to park. And I watched a very elderly citizen in the same situation park way the heck down the street. And I know Tom's, I'm sure, was accommodating and took her groceries way down the street. But I don't think an elder, of 75 to 80 plus should have to do that. I don't know what the answer is. I'm not saying I would really just love to raise the awareness of it, but I think police presence on the street or more effort in the parking thing, because frankly there's a potential money thing there too. But when visitors disrespect our space, my home, my space where I'm at, and we did have a local church, you may have heard about this, where parking was done on the grass of the church. That's private property. They have no business being there. Why anyone would think that's okay to do that is beyond me. But I don't see this quieting down. I see this getting worse and worse and worse. So for me, and I know a lot of other people, okay, I'm on the side, a police presence would be important. And enforce the parking laws. We have regulations. Enforce them. Thank you.
Anyone else?
Hi, I'm Rick Sanders. This isn't really so much as a comment as just a question. I live on East Enon Road, 414 East Enon. It's not really, I don't think it's officially in the village, but it's adjacent to the Glass Farm. Anyway, we had heard about plans for the Glass Farm off and on. In fairness, we hadn't always read the paper, and we weren't making a point of being up to date on it. But we were a little surprised Friday morning to see people cutting down trees out there, and there's really nothing wrong with what they were doing. We have no complaint about that, but I would like to keep up on from, you know, from henceforth, I'd like to keep up on the progress of the plans for the glass farm and know the best way to track that, you know, or to just to be, stay in touch with that, so I don't, so it doesn't drop off our radar again.
Well, I, as I explained in my email to you, Mr.
Oh, yeah, Sanders, thanks.
We're going to send letters, excuse me, when we get the construction schedule for the solar array.
Right.
We're going to send the letters out to all the adjacent property owners. In fact, I have all of the printouts on my desk of all of the adjacent property owners all the way around the glass farm, so that we can let you know what's going on and what's going to be happening. But we don't have that firmed up yet. I expect those letters to go out next week. And as council continues to discuss the use of the rest of the glass farm, you'll be kept apprised in the same manner. If there's a public hearing or something coming up for discussion, we'll do that.
Is there a, was some other commission, did I hear? Planning commission or something? Did, at some point there was mention of some other commission that sounded like a subgroup of
the energy board?
Yeah, but maybe that would be the most appropriate one. Are these, are those open
for yes, public? They're all the meetings are open, all the boards and commission meetings are open.
Okay.
But I mean, different things are covered by different boards and commissions.
Yeah,
so
I suppose
the solar array, which is what we're preparing for now, is the energy board.
Right. Okay.
Anyway. And I would also suggest, Rick, that you just look at our, kind of track our agendas. Our agendas are in the Yellow Springs News.
Yeah.
And then if you see an agenda item that's Glass Farm, you know, you might want to attend these meetings, because essentially decisions are made at these meetings as opposed to the commission meetings, where they're typically discussing and potentially making proposals that come to council, but will make final decisions. So. I mean, there's a lot happening, so it's probably going to be tough to keep up on all of the different aspects. Environmental Commission is involved with the, and there's a Beaver Management Task Force, so there's a number of commissions involved in that project.
Right. Yeah. And I believe Judy puts all of the agendas online as well.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Okay, great. Thanks.
He might want the copy that we got last time from Ken LeBlanc that sort of lays out the...
Well, yeah, it's the last packet.
Not the plan for it exactly, but a potential.
The packet from last meeting is still online. You can look that up.
All right, great. Appreciate it.
Thanks, Rick. Anyone else? Okay, we'll move on to, to special reports. So we have the Economic Sustainability Commission end of year report, and a report on the work that was done regarding the Center for Business and Education survey work. And I see that Saul is here, the chair of Economic Sustainability.
Thank you. I know that we published an annual report, and I'm assuming you guys have it.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, and they're also out on the table,
So I don't know how you would like me to proceed. I'd rather not just stand here and read it word for word.
Maybe summarize each of the categories just to kind of, I think we always like to hear who's on the commission. It's also always good to talk about who's on the commission and then, you know, maybe just do a brief summary of each of the items that have been worked on. And I also like the citizen concerns guest. I also think that that's something nice to share, the people that have come to talk to the commission.
Well, we'll start with that then. Current members are myself, Saul Greenberg, Henry Myers, Emily Siebel, Susan Jennings, Luciana Lee, Dino Pilata, Mark Crockett represents the township, and council representatives are Ryan and Karen. Just to skip to one of the last things that Karen mentioned and then come back to our report, there's always a section of time in the beginning of any commission meeting where guests are welcome to come and express concerns.
Hey, Saul, sorry to interrupt, but if you do want to talk to the audience, you might want to grab the mic so that our television audience can hear you as well.
Thank you. Portable. That's nice. So citizen concerns guests over a period of approximately a year and a half were representatives from SpringsNet, Kathy Page regarding Yellow Springs Wellness Collective, Kat Walters regarding Local Economy Month, Susan Jennings regarding the Arthur Morgan Institute for Community Solutions looking for a location for a shared community commercial kitchen, Krista McGaw regarding the efforts of the Tecumseh Land Trust in trying to protect the Jacoby Creek, Irene Bedard from Green Energy Corp regarding indigenous solutions, microgrid solutions.
Can you explain what that is?
Which one?
Irene.
Yeah, let me come back to that and just finish this. There's okay. One more. Julia and Tim Honschel regarding local organic farming. Irene Bedard is involved with a company called Green Energy Corporation, and it involves a lot of Native Americans who have a company producing solar panels in an array which can be organized for microgrid solutions, and that can be for either private homes or collectively put together for larger groups of solar arrays. And she's, you know, she came as a guest and only took a few minutes, but she offered to come back either to the commission or any other arena in town to make a full presentation.
Maybe the energy board?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's that really interesting. She was leaving the next day to lobby in Washington, D.C. about these issues. And so I think it would be very nice to follow up on.
Thank you.
We can put it on our agenda, and council can encourage it also.
Well, I would think the energy board.
I think the energy board would be in next place.
Yeah.
Oh,
so
even better.
I request
good.
Judith that
okay,
she gets
so
invited to.
Will somebody then from council direct
Judith.
That?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'll get contact information.
Good. So that's taken care of. Thank you. So some of the business that we've been charged with and that we've been working on have to do with the revolving loan fund. And there is some money that was left over from the past, and we determined that it's approximately $30,000. Policies have been worked on regarding how the revolving loan fund would be managed, distributed, what various criteria would be. We looked at previous resolutions from council and ways in which the revolving loan fund has been used in the past, and decided to try to update it. We went from a very long document, pulling together all the previous documents, to something that we're very close to streamlining for current use. In the process of researching all this and talking about it over so many meetings, we also came across a wonderful connection for us with the Yellow Springs Federal Credit Union, and the director has spent several hours talking with us, Sandy Hollenberg. Many of us probably know her. She's the director of the credit union. And the credit union would like to be more involved, even on a volunteer basis, with the village, and has offered to manage in some of the nuts and bolts ways that the revolving loan fund would be utilized, because part of the problem comes down to the everyday business of tracking a loan, doing the paperwork, and so on. And then we look at village staff and whether or not we have the capacity to manage that. And in this case now, the credit union has come forward volunteering to do that for us. So it's a matter of the Economic Sustainability Commission making a final proposal to council for council to approve, disapprove, modify in some ways before we go forward with the actual mechanics. In addition to the $30,000 that has been identified, we're also looking, and Emily Seibel has been very active, along with Susan Jennings, talking with, and Karen arranged, and Brian and some other people were very involved with it, representatives from the USDA coming here to the village and talking about their, what they call the Rural Economic Development Loan and Grant Program. So there's an opportunity going forward for us to apply for those funds and use it to add considerably to our revolving loan fund. Any more that I'm leaving out about the RLF?
No, I think that's great.
Okay, so that's a big one, but it ties in real closely with something else we've been working on and have not finalized, but these two should come together pretty quickly now, which would be an incentive program. So incentives, a village incentive policy actually exists de facto and has been in print. But again, to update and put in a little more of this into current policy language, the village incentive policy deals with things like traditional income tax abatements, extending of utilities, negotiating utility rates, tying in with the revolving loan fund, and possibly supporting grants from outside institutions. There may be more ways of incentivizing people to do business with the village. There may be some of those ways that fold in neatly with a revolving loan fund, but some of the incentives also exist outside of any revolving loan fund. And what we're looking at in terms of setting policy is guidelines, but not rigidities. Because we continue to find in our discussions that there could very well be a lot of individual cases that don't fit a mold that we're imagining today. Which leads me to make a general comment about the Economic Sustainability Commission. That is that we're always welcoming input because what has worked in the past to some degree could very well work again for us going forward into the future. Some of the things that we already envision as futuristic, we very well could use. But in terms of combinations and recombinations of technology and social ways of interacting, we recognize that we're in a 21st century new zone. And we have to be creative, not wild necessarily, but intelligent, and welcome input. We'll need it. We need good ideas, fresh ideas, recombinations of all the energy that already exists within us and around us. We need to capture it and to put it into really unique combinations for Yellow Springs. So we welcome visitors, we welcome input. Another big project that we've been involved with recently is what is it?
Maybe you said this. That money that's available and that's no longer being, I mean, is there are we moving towards a process where people could apply for?
Yeah, so what Saul was getting at is that very soon there's going to be a recommendation coming to council.
Okay.
And that's been, you know, working with the Federal Credit Union and the commission to get that presentable so that we can then look at the process.
Okay.
Yep.
There have been some other projects that got us off schedule.
Okay.
But I think we're ready to wrap that up in some form that, you know, is acceptable. So one of those has to do with the 35 acres for referred to as a Center for Business and Education. And one of the things council charged the Economic Sustainability Commission with was getting some input from our public about ideas, feelings, thoughts regarding that land and the use of it. So there were several different sources of information for us. There were information boxes put out around town, and a number of citizens made comments and dropped them in the box. There was an opportunity online for people to send in their comments, and we had a community forum where we met and people face-to-face shared thoughts and feelings. We did some analysis of this. It wasn't designed in the first place to be a scientific survey. It was really consisting of open-ended questions, and it has produced a lot of rich information for us to consider. I don't know exactly how we want to. Do we want to report that out right
yeah,
now?
Yeah, I was going to say, Saul, maybe we could transition into that after you see if there are any other questions from council members about, you know, just what the commission's been doing. Okay, so yeah, let's go to the CVE summary.
Okay, so, and maybe I can get a little help from Ms. Hanning on how we put together some of the information from the surveys and so on.
Sure.
If you are comfortable perhaps presenting what we summarized, given again the qualification that this is not scientific, but it's worthwhile. Want to give it a shot? Sammy helped us out a lot with this.
Could I have a copy of the report just to...
Here.
Okay.
Sammy, could you tell us who you are?
Yeah, my name is Sammy Sauber. I'm just a citizen right now. I did some work to help out the ESC. And I helped kind of analyze this data and write the report. So the first question revolved around values, and the second question revolved around needs. So what values do village residents want to see the use of the land fulfill? And at the same time, what things do the village need that they want to see that land fulfilled? And this was basically just done by looking at words or phrases that were commonly used in the responses. The more kind of intensive work was done around question three, which is what should be done with the land. So we basically categorized this as we looked at all the responses and tried to summarize the intent of what people wanted. And we broke that down into categories. Green space, farmland, or basically people wanted to see nothing done with it. Economic development, housing, and energy. And then in the following pages, I basically summarized the responses in a series of pie charts. And so what you see is that based on the responses that we received, the majority of the responses wanted to see some kind of economic development, and they did not want to see things like energy
the land used for energy or housing. In terms of economic development, because that was the most important, that was the biggest thing that everybody said they wanted to see on the land, I broke that down into categories. So for example, hospitality, like restaurants and hotels, retail, technology companies, light industry and big business and chain. And I should also make note that this is not just broken down to what residents wanted to see, but also what they did not want to see the land used for. And so basically, overwhelmingly, people wanted to see some kind of light industry or tech companies move in to that land, and they did not want to see any kind of retail or anything. So yeah, that's basically the results. I'll pass the rest to Saul.
So, thank you. So again, this was a stab at getting a conversation going. And one of the things that we talked about at our previous last meeting was carrying this conversation, this village conversation, a little bit further forward with maybe another public session that would have some educational aspects to it, for instance, in terms of what covenants might be attached right now to the use of that land, what people's concepts are in terms of use of the land for energy, the different types of energy projections that people mentioned, from windmill to solar, and how that in reality might be able to be done or not be done, so that we would have some educational component to moving forward that could give a little more intelligent shape to the conversation, knowing that this conversation about what to do with that land is not over, it's not formulated yet, and it's a matter of moving forward together.
All right. Thanks, Saul.
I think it's important to note that, and you may have said this, Saul, and if you did, I'm sorry, but all of the responses from all three venues of survey, whether it be SurveyMonkey, the boxes, or the public forum that we had, are recorded. They're in the packet. So anybody that participated, their thoughts are going to continue with this project, so and with this discussion. So I don't want anybody to think that somehow things are going to get lost or put aside. So so I think.
Questions?
Sure. Yeah.
Can council speak?
Yeah. Let's have council ask questions first. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I have a couple comments. First of all, in terms of a future forum, I would like to see some education around historically what's happened in Yellow Springs vis-a-vis local businesses, rise of local businesses, fall of local businesses, impact on taxes, land use percent, and I don't know if we have that information, but the percentage over time of land that's been used for commercial purposes, and how that may have shifted over time. And particularly what I'm interested in is to be able to demonstrate how the loss of local businesses has negatively impacted our tax base and how it negatively impacts people who live here, because it effectively raises the property taxes for people who live here. So that's the one thing I think is really important as we're looking at this. The other is a comment, which is something I didn't know. Something's happening out there. I wasn't aware that Wilberforce University owned most of Dayton Street, I guess, and had a big influence on businesses, especially on Dayton Street, and I think that is very interesting, and I don't know if that's being promoted as part of the, is it 365 that's doing the tours, or some?
Yes, they are putting together and asking for solicitations from folks on black involvement within Yellow Springs.
Business particular,
Doctor,
for looking at that?
Yeah, Dr. Magruder from the college has been working on it.
I mean, that is really interesting, important to know about the past and mm-hmm. implications that it has, as is said here, for future collaboration. I'm done.
Thanks, Marian. Any other comments or questions? So any comments or questions from citizens, Dan? But please do come up just so we can hear you.
Yeah, I didn't want to barge up with you. Yeah.
I was prompted by the reports from the commission and the packet, and it's a set of issues with the land out there, the known as CBE, that we've been talking about in some form or another for many years here. I think it's an interest, there's some interesting opportunities there. I suppose, appreciating what Saul was saying about this being a kind of initial step and getting some things going again and getting some voices out there. But it's also it's kind of a newly framed phase for this project, whatever it is, if it's a project that's come back to the village. That you know that it's a parcel of land, you could call it that. I mean, it is essentially that. That's fully within village control. One of the things that's interesting in the packet is the return to the old notion of the covenant. Essentially, the covenant at this point approaches being pretty close to what the village wishes in accordance with public opinion as it stands. I mean, the village is both the owner and the regulator of this land, if we're talking the village inclusively, broadly, democratically. And I think that's where some of the interesting opportunities rest with this parcel at this point, is for it to be a true broad democratic decision-making process, to the extent that the village can be engaged and energized about that. I mean, there may be ultimately, you know, parts of this land that are used in the categories of public or private, or some folks would even say common is another type of category of land that we forget about sometimes. But we really have an opportunity to envision what sort of addition to the village this space might make. So I guess, you know, I appreciate the work that's been going on, but it's also hope we don't neglect examining the democratic community potentials for this opportunity for us to really look at it and bring people in and maybe think a little bit outside of the boxes that we've had. I guess you guys were saying you've tried to use open-ended instruments as much as possible. That's a good first thing to do, you know, not just try to picture what you see as you drive around the Miami Valley, but think about what we need, what we might desire for this community to be distinctive.
Thanks, Dan. Anyone else? So it sounds like, Judith, did you have?
Well, I was just thinking, going off of what Dan said, just that we remember, you know, we've been talking about the CBE and CBE. I like to call it CBE land right now. We've been talking about it for years, but we are in a different situation. The village now owns the land. And so that, you know, I hope that would mean that we can be more effective at making something happen out there, since we have control. We're the elected representatives, and that that we can move forward with something in the near term.
Can I just point out,
Saul, come on up just so we can hear you.
I said this, but I forgot. The whole context of this conversation is different now with the Jacoby land sale
and also the decisions about the use of the glass farm. So even though we have a previous history about this particular piece of land, the context has changed very much. And that will, I'm sure, come into play as people visualize and conceptualize what is going to be brought forth currently. It's new and different now.
Great. Well, I mean, I think in keeping with what people have said, with what Dan said, you know, we're talking about how we continue this public process. So Mary Ann had some suggestions for content for another forum. I think, you know, looking at the covenants, looking at some of the other materials that have kind of historically been informing this discussion. And I mean, I assume we need to go back to the Economic Sustainability Commission needs to go back, maybe do a little bit of planning for that forum and picking of a date. And
we have a date, don't we, for another forum?
That became a to be determined.
Oh, I see.
Partly because of the Coretta Scott King.
So it's not going to be on the 27th?
No. Okay. Yeah, well, I guess first of all, I want to thank the commission for the thoughtful work. And what I appreciate is that the information was summarized. And, you know, there weren't any sort of, you know, analysis or, you know, any kind of opinions put in there. So I think that was really important. I definitely agree that with the recommendation that we should have some kind of educational, I don't know if it's a work session or what we're thinking about. Because I also think it's important to clarify the covenants, because I know that's not something everybody's familiar with. And, you know, just sort of what the restrictions are now. With the caveat that those could change if, for example, housing came up as a popular piece for part of that land. The other piece is understanding the goals around the Greenbelt, which is why that document was in the packet, and of course some of the historical reference with the vision work that was done. I also think if we have kind of drilled down on certain values, like we want to spread the cost of utilities, we want to think about affordability, I'd like to see some analysis on what are the best uses to make that happen. So if we're starting to come together with some kind of consensus about what values are important, I think delving into what's going to deliver on that would be critical in sort of shaping what's going to happen in the future. So just having said that, it sounds like council would like the ESC to schedule a second forum, is mm-hmm. that?
And I would think that Melissa, finance director and assistant manager, could actually provide some input regarding, you know, size of a business for utilities and income tax revenue so I think that maybe we can get a little bit more staff involvement in that regard.
Right. You just need to know specifics. I mean, we have to know a specific business that you'd like us to look at. I mean,
right.
Everything. You know, you can give us 20 businesses and we can come up with the information.
Mm. Can the county assist with that? The economic development.
Mm.
It's possible.
The
county
development.
Mm-hmm. It's
yeah,
possible.
They might have some of that information.
Mm-hmm.
But this packet was very helpful. I mean, it contained graphs and charts and from like the last 7 years, right? I mean, information from the vision on up to the last forum. I thought it was very helpful. Thank you.
So when we end up nominating Sammy Saber to the commission.
He's the graph man. Okay, great. This was, yes, thanks, guys. This was a good discussion. Good presentation. Okay, moving on. I see we have our friends here from the 365 Project, the policing vision statement. I'm not exactly sure how that's going to kick off, if anybody in council is going to kick that off, if I should just turn it over to the 365 group.
Yep.
Okay.
Do you want to go ahead and start, and then we can...
Well, I guess I can just say that Janet and Louise came to the Justice System Task Force meeting last week. We had a maybe 30-minute discussion. JSTF threw out some comments, some ideas. Some of it was incorporated, some of it wasn't. But the JSTF appreciated the statement as it had currently been, or as it had been previously, and wanted to say, basically, we would like to support this statement as a policing vision for the village as a whole, not just from 365, but that it would be a village statement that would help to, that would be a living document that would no doubt be changing over time, but that would help to be used specifically for hiring. It would be used around hiring issues and around evaluation issues for our police department. I'm done. So.
I may call on them to help me.
Should I recap a little bit about how we got to here to catch people up?
Sure.
Would that be helpful? Okay.
If you could just give your name.
Yes, I can certainly do that. Thank you for the reminder. I'm Janet Mueller. Hello, everybody.
Hello,
I'm face this way so the microphone hears me, but if anyone, I'll try to
acknowledge that you're all there too.
I don't want to pick it up, so I'm too many things. So, what's now we're calling the guidelines for village policing was developed from a document that came from council a few years ago that was called the Vision for Community Policing, I believe. And we worked, the 365 Police Policy Committee, which is a subgroup of the 365 Project, thought it would be valuable to, given the changes that have happened in our police department, look at this again and see how this could help us have some direction as we go forward. So we looked at the listening sessions that the HRC did in 2015. We read articles from the newspaper and also did research on other police departments around the country and pulled together some things we thought that would enhance and really clearly state the things that we were hearing in the village and reading and researching that we felt were important. So. From there, we gathered input from some people and got direction to go to the Justice System Task Force to, since they're sort of the commission, or that's not, they're not a commission, the committee, the body, the
task force
that is working on these kind of issues, and had, I think, a really valuable discussion at that meeting about some of the ideas in this document. So from there, we wanted to come to council to share with you sort of the progress we've made over the course of the last few months on the document. And we really think that, this is the long haul kind of work, like a lot of work of council, that police changes in police community relations and creating a progressive police department is something that doesn't happen overnight, but we have an opportunity given the changes that have happened recently and sort of the awareness of the community that's really raised between national issues and local issues. And so we think the timing is well for really taking advantage of that and sort of putting forth a vision. And we think it will be helpful because there are so many different sort of subgroups working on police issues, whether it's the Justice System Task Force, there are many committees, public groups like 365 Projects, as well as the village manager and the chief of police, all kind of bringing forth different initiatives, that would be helpful for all of these groups and people to have something to help us sort of have a focal point. So that's really where we're coming from.
Anything, Gavin? Janet, you want to just, for the people out here who maybe haven't seen it, just at least the highlighted sections that were kind of your focal.
Sure. There are copies in the hallway if you would like to read it. It starts with sort of an overarching vision where the village of Yellow Springs has a progressive police department that helps ensure a safe and welcoming environment for those who live, work, and visit. And some of the things it also includes is has four different sub areas, including being safety centered, being peaceful, demonstrably inclusive, and locally minded. We felt it, there were a couple of things that really stood out to people and people often commented on that were added, including the importance of
local-minded is still something that's we hear again and again, that's really important to members of this community, but also being really aware of the challenges of racism and the historical challenges in our country around police and people of color, that even though we work hard in this community to address, we still experience, and being proactively working to be anti-racist and not just not racist. And that idea of being proactive is a really important part of that racial justice component, which is obviously very important to the 365 Project. There's lots of other things too, but that's probably what I would highlight.
So what would our, I mean, are we, is this something that, I guess, since if this is essentially replacing the community policing vision for community policing, I guess we would want to have some sort of action to adopt it. I mean, do we have further discussion? Has Chief Carlson reviewed it?
Mm-hmm. What I would imagine is that we would put it into legislation so that it's clearly a policy of the village, that this would be used as a vision, a guideline, a vision of the community for our PD, not the internal vision of the department, and that it would be used for, as I said, hiring, in hiring, and also in evaluations. So I would imagine a resolution if council supports the idea.
And what does that mean about the status of the local policing vision? I mean, are we adding to it? Or
the one that you guys did initially. Uh-huh. This is we saw that as a living document, and basically this would be replacing it.
Okay. Yes.
I mean, it looks like it's merging. I mean, it did retain much of that. So, and is this something, I guess I still get back, you know, as we're moving along in this process, it's a bigger process, it's a big process with the JSTF. And I definitely agree that the sooner we can get some of this stuff legislative and really attached as policy, that's a good thing. This is probably, as you say, it's a living document. It's probably broad enough at this point that I'm comfortable. Brian, I know you and Marianne both worked very long on the other one. Are there things that you would like to add, or do you have questions or anything you'd like to see changed?
Marianne?
Well, I wouldn't add anything. I think it might be tightened up a bit, but that's the only thing. And some of the just wordsmithing a little bit. But on the other hand, given that if it's a living document, I'm not sure how important that is. A lot of people have worked on it, so.
Mm-hmm. My only thing is, you know, just getting this a couple of days ago, I really wasn't sure what the objective was. But I know you and Brian had worked hard on another document, so I hadn't had a chance to compare this one to the one that you guys worked on.
Yeah, that would maybe be good to have the comparison documents.
Well, not to say I haven't had a chance to make that comparison, mm-hmm. but I'd like a little bit of time at least to do that.
I like it. I think it there are a lot of things that are emphasized in this document that maybe weren't in the prior document, and I think it's a reflection of the fact that this is a evolving situation and evolving in a positive way, I think, at this point. One thing I do remember that we talked a lot about amongst council with the prior, and it is the local policing vision, not community policing, was putting in some concrete examples to highlight that behavior. And arguably, maybe that's something that could still be in this document. It doesn't mean that it couldn't be added later, as we talked about. But I remember that being something I thought was important and helpful.
Well, just to say, 365 certainly shared the original document, and their document many times.
Right.
In their effort to get us to get to this point. But I would like to suggest, you know, I know what Jerry's saying, he'd like to be able, because they weren't both put in this packet, but what I would suggest is that we, assuming in general counsel is ready to consider legislation that would say these are the guidelines, so there would be a resolution saying these are the guidelines, you know, attached are the guidelines for village policing. And in the resolution, it would say that how it would be used. And we, you know, we didn't want, we wanted it to be legislation because of what happened to the prior document. I mean, that's one of the reasons we want it to be legislation, because we want it to be policy that is being followed. And there seemed to be a disjuncture between the vision that council had supported and actually what was happening in our police department.
Right.
So we just wanted to make it very clear that this is, you know, this is policy and this is how it's going to be used. But I would suggest that we go ahead and put it in the next packet. Council will have, you know, as a resolution. And then if there's any further comments that people can prepare, any wordsmithing anybody wants to do. I don't think we want to ask these guys to do it. They've been doing it for, unless they die to do it. That they've done, you know, they've been taking input. And so I wonder if you guys want to just hand it off and if there's a, I mean, not that the wordsmithing would be happening for the next meeting, but that at the next meeting, if people bring some little changes that we can discuss it.
And I do just want to emphasize something you said, Judith, which is the most important thing I read in this document, and we've said it many times, is the need to operationalize this policy. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, that's the thing that's really important to me. And so I guess I did have a couple notes. I think it's really important that the focus is on safe and welcoming. I also really like the emphasis on consistent and meaningful community engagement. And I guess I want to take that as an opportunity to say to Chief Carlson that I want to make sure that that's something that all of our officers are, you know, doing in a meaningful way. You know, that it's not just sort of who likes doing it, you know, but or who's, I guess, most apt to do it, but making sure that that's something that everybody on the force is committed to. So
can would you give some examples of what you're talking about, because I think that makes it more meaningful.
Me?
You.
Yeah.
You're the one that just said it.
Yeah, well, sure. I mean, so I always refer to, I love when I see our officers helping someone at Tom's shop because he or she is not really capable of doing that mentally or because of their age. I love when I read the stories in the police report to talk about someone, an officer taking the time to help someone get into their car to mediate some of the barking dog disturbances between neighbors and that sort of thing. But I guess I'm also thinking about, I love what our youth has been doing in terms of creating events for officers. And I want that to be something that, I mean, I always see Brian Carlson there. I always see Dave Meister there. I want to make sure that all our officers are getting those opportunities to be part of those events. Opening Day for Trails was another great one. And so, you know, I love seeing the usual suspects, but I also think it's really important in this initiative that we're pulling in all our officers so that they see how great these events are, you know, how cool it is to engage with our community.
I guess, I would like to hear either from Patty or from Chief Carlson, and maybe even from Chris, you know, what if this is passed as legislation, where does it go? I mean, if it's just a resolution, it doesn't go in our ordinance book. So would it go in the general orders manual? How exactly does this document become an operational part of the department that they're required to read, that they're required to understand? Is that something you all have discussed?
We have, well, briefly, yes. I think that the simplest way to do that is to make it a general order and part of the general orders manual. You know, I don't know that we want to renumber the entire thing, but perhaps it could be an introduction to the general orders manual.
I would agree with that. I mean, the logical place is we're doing it by resolution. You want the flexibility of change.
Right.
That if you put it in the manual, where it fits somewhere between mission statement and policy, because it's really a broader set of guidelines rather than a mandate of specific conduct, because I think the intention is larger principles. Is that right? So that place, I think, between mission statement and direct policy.
So could it become like a preamble or something like that?
Right. I mean, and it should be something that potential officers read. It should be something almost more so than the ones we've hired, because hopefully if they're being hired, they've read and understood this. So it really is about, this is what our police department is about. So, and it, you know, so it probably needs to be part of, somehow be part of something that isn't just the general orders manual, because I'm assuming, is it like this? I'm just picturing this large book and I'm wondering how many people read it and when they read it. So, I mean, I wish there was some, a little bit more accessible sort of document, accessible sort of...
The review of that general orders manual with their field training officer is a requirement of field training.
But this document, we just got it. Mm-hmm. At least I just got it. So to say that, you know, our new officers and officers being hired have read and understood this, I don't think that's a fair statement.
I'm saying after it. After
in the
it's. Okay. Yeah, I mean, I just want to understand how we're going to make this.
Okay.
How we're going to make sure everyone understands it to begin with.
Maybe it could be posted in the department.
Hi, I'm Louise Smith, and helped to craft some of this, and actually council has seen some version of it before. I would just want to posit that it go on the website, on the page for YSPD. I think it is a public-facing document. It sort of puts our identity out there as a village and the principles that we want to adhere to in terms of our policing, and I think it sort of, you know, positions us for potential officers who would be hired, and kind of thinking about, you know, right fit for the village. I think it's I think one of the lessons we've learned recently is, you know, that we need to be very, you know, we need to attract the right kind of officers here, and that would help us if it was on the website. So that would be in the orders as a preamble, and then also on the website of the police department. I think I'm excited about that. I think I would love to see our village step out like that.
I mean, I also like the idea of a very abbreviated, I mean, if somebody talks about hanging it on the wall, this doesn't work on the wall. No. I mean, I'm thinking of a very abbreviated, just, you know,
bullet point
that really could be on the wall, that could be something that folks see and understand, whether it be officers, whether it be visitors, whoever it might be. So, you know, that's something, and maybe that's something, because I see you folks as the more the philosophical kind of thinking piece of this, and maybe that's something you guys could think about.
I don't think any of us would say, like, okay, we're out, like, you know, thank you, here's this document. No, I mean, I think we see this as one part of the work that we hope to continue to do, and so helping figure out how to operationalize it, working with the Justice System Task Force and the Chief and Patty to do that, I think it's still part of our plan. I mean, some of it's already happening, I mean, in lots of ways in terms of what the village and the officers and the task force are already doing. So I think we're in a place where we are better prepared to operationalize it because of all the work that's already happening too. So, yeah, but we'd be happy to work on that.
And some of the specific language will aid the department in function, growth, and discipline.
Mm-hmm.
So
I just wanted to point out, I think this, the one, you know, when we think of standard police work, not the helping with the groceries, but the actual, you know, what we think of as more standard police work, I just want to read out this section. The community expects the YSPD to deal effectively with criminal activity using best practices, data, and research to guide the work. The department will serve victims of crime with professionalism and care. It was just noted, you know, in our conversation that we need to remember the victims of crime, mm-hmm. and that, you know, how they're dealt with by the police is also a very important piece. So that got added, I think.
So Marianne mentioned some wordsmithing. and that maybe there were some things that could be, let's just call it wordsmithing. Brian mentioned maybe examples being added, something, and so I guess what I'm asking is, are we essentially okay? And I realize, Jerry, you know, you've need to read it, but do we want this document in the next packet, or is somebody going to work on it, a slightly different document? Are we going to change this document to do any further editing or wordsmithing?
Gavin,
go ahead. And that's kind of you.
Hi, Gavin DeVore Leonard. Just that there were versions that had, like, it's one of these things, some people wanted more, some people wanted less, so some of these things, like some of the examples, for instance, got taken out because people that wanted it shorter. So if there is an opportunity to, for instance, make a really short version that would try to go on a placard or on a one-pager, and then there could be a longer version, we could take some of these concepts that we've tried to shorten and change to, you know, because get it into two pages, and build it out a little bit with, if you gave us a, you know, a little bit of context on the, you know, on the audiences, we could, you know, have a base. If this was sort of a good foundation, then we could do these other edits if that's helpful.
Well, that's interesting.
Not to hold up the process, but just after we could get the basis done, we could work from there, I think, right?
Okay, thanks, Gavin. What do you think about that, Brian? Does that maybe satisfy?
Yeah, I think that sounds good. Yeah, because I do love the idea about something that's bulleted that could be on the wall and small card in all the police cars and everything. And then I like that idea of an expanded version as well. I think that sounds great.
Okay.
Yeah, I think it's nice that it's two pages. I just did not get a chance to compare it to the other, but I would be ready, you know, if we decide to bring it back as a resolution or whatever at the next meeting, I'll be ready for it.
Okay.
But I think they did a great job. I just didn't have, I got it this morning.
Right. Okay. So let's plan on bringing that back to the next legislation, to the next meeting. Judy, and would you also include the current vision, local policing vision, in that for comparison? Thank you to the 365 group and to the JSTF. Lots of good work going on. Next item on the agenda is an update regarding the chief search process. Judith wrote a document that she put in the packet, but I wanted to say a couple of things first because I've heard a couple of comments that somehow this process that we're going through we're not being transparent in this process and the discussion that we're going through about the chief search. And when I think we've talked about that topic more than anything, we spent more hours on that topic in this year than we've spent on anything else. We aren't having a chief search right now. What we decided at the March 20th meeting is that we're going to delay. Judith has a proposal that we're going to talk about. I don't know if we'll make any decisions tonight, but we're not currently conducting a police search or a chief search, so we don't have any active resumes from external or internal for any candidates because we have not opened up the process for a chief search. So, I don't think we need to go into all the details of any timelines, but I just wanted to be clear about that there hasn't been any intent to sweep under the rug that there are other potential internal candidates or external candidates, but there just isn't a search happening right now. So, Judith, I'll just turn it over to you to review your proposal, and we'll kind of decide where to go from there.
Okay. Well, actually, it's from me and Brian.
Okay.
I just started hearing some rumors, and I talked to Brian about it because we've been working on some of these things together. Just concerns because when we put the search on hold, there was nothing. There was no plan when we're going to come back to it or anything like that. And then there seemed to be concerns also by our employee policies when there's an internal, when there's a position open, it is posted internally, so there were some concerns about that that I was kind of hearing through the grapevine. So just to lay that all to rest. And also, I mean, we have, you know, our acting chief not knowing when he, you know, it's all kind of just up in the air. It's not really fair to anybody, and it just, it's, so we decided to think about kind of just a time frame to put around this and to acknowledge that we would have the position posted internally and that we would decide whether we were going to have a more extensive search or not, and that the date would be that we would start that discussion the first meeting of July of the council meeting. So in our statement, we just also wanted to acknowledge that we feel like a lot of progress, that Chief Carlson's made a lot of progress in stabilizing our police department, has you know, started the process of healing and trust building and done a great job for him, for as the chief, but also for our whole police department. I think there's, I think people have, there's just been a calm, calmness that has come into the village. People are not really anxious and worried about it. So I think that's really great. So that's what we were proposing, just that we put that time frame around it, and we said, you know, we will definitely post it internally, but that we're, in terms of a more extensive search, that we would decide that in July. I should say with our village manager.
I would like to suggest to council that, first of all, I think it's good to put some kind of a time frame, and I'm not saying that you shouldn't do that. But I would like the opportunity to talk with Chief Carlson first before you say it's going to be in July, because we've had some private discussions that I would like to revisit with him and then come back to council maybe on May the 1st. And at that time, if we're both in agreement with that time frame,
okay,
then council can do that.
I would just like to remind council and citizens that hiring of the chief is under the purview of the village manager. Now, clearly, the village manager is going to be savvy about this and have council behind her. But just so you know, it's not up to council to really to making these decisions. It's up to the village manager, who ideally we're going to be in alignment on this.
Thank you.
And I agree with that, although I do think that we did pledge to the community that how we go about the process would be a discussion. And I think that's the discussion we're having, is not necessarily who the candidate is, which is clearly the manager's choice, from including community input, because right. I'm sure if there is a search, there will be a process where she will get community input. And that's really what we're doing now, is kind of deciding how that community input is going to happen, how that process is going to happen. So it sounds like, you know, we're good with putting a time frame. Patty's good with putting a time frame, but she wants to have to be able to input on what that exact schedule is with council at a later time. I agree with the last paragraph about continuing. Is the description done? The job description?
The description is done. Janet, Pat, and I worked on that for 3 months, I think it was, and we're actually in the midst of designing the process itself when council decided to put it on hold. So we just stopped meeting until there was a decision as to how that was going to move forward. But the description, the position description itself, is done and ready to go.
Okay. So what's the plan for that, the job description?
Well, I haven't done anything with it because council put the search on hold. So
I'd like for us to expedite it. You know, if we wait for July, that's as Brian's been in this interim position for almost 7 months. Mm-hmm. And then if we decide to go out with the process, it's even longer. And I feel that Brian has made some commitments, you know, to us, but he can't effectively do much more in an interim position
And, you know, I, you know, we have received numerous communications from villagers since January. Some people put Brian in the position. You know, you may have received some unfavorable ones, but the majority that we've been getting have been favorable responses to his actions as he's been interim and has been represented in the new officers that he has brought on, plus the officers that are now on duty. I think everybody in the community has been seeing, you know, a big change in the department. And I hope when we look at that, at this, we take that into consideration. And as I said before numerous times, finding an individual outside of the community around the country that really understands and could possibly work in Yellow Springs is going to be very difficult. But we have an individual that has lived here, worked here, he understands the community, and the community seems to be rallying around him. So, you know, I hear Patty say that you wanted to talk with Brian and have something by May to bring back at the May meeting, but, you know, my feeling is that, you know, and if there weren't technicalities that we had to go through, I'm in favor of saying we should offer Brian a 3-year contract and let's move forward and get the job done. Because, you know, just from what I see, it appears that there are many more good things that he would like to do, but you can't do it as interim. So,
I appreciate where you're coming from, Jerry, in terms of, I mean, I almost felt like July was too long also. Mm-hmm. But I do want to say, in terms of the village council's involvement in these discussions and this decision, I believe that this is something that perhaps council needs to look at. I think this is such an important position. Our citizens expect to have input. The council, in a lot of ways, is held responsible for that decision. And the way that our charter sets it, in fact, we're supposed to have no input. And I think that doesn't really work. I don't actually think it works. So I think, you know, that's maybe a discussion for another day. But I think it's a discussion that we should consider in the not too distant future. But to wait longer than July, I think I also agree is too long.
My personal opinion is that a meeting ago, two meetings ago, we said we were putting this on hold. Yeah. We just took it off of hold, and I think we need to continue with the discussion. I think to put the discussion on hold until July now just doesn't make sense. I think we should just keep moving forward as we've been moving. Chris, I have a question for you. Has it been determined that our employee handbook requires internal posting of positions?
Well, it seems to me that given the context of your discussion, I'm not sure that the answer really matters. It's clearly Brian's under consideration. But I can only speak to the past interpretation of how we've done it, which I guess that we didn't post internally, did we?
What the manual says is that when there is a vacancy, the village manager decides whether to post it internally, externally, or both.
Right, and I guess I think the problem with that language, well, I do want to speak to this, is it's ambiguous because it says whether, right? So that can imply all of those or none of them. However, I do think it's best practice to post internally, and well, so I think we should do that.
And we have had, as was mentioned at a previous meeting, there were other internal employees who asked about the position, as well as numerous external interested parties.
Are we talking about the interim position?
No, we're talking about the permanent position.
Oh.
There have been no applications yet because it's hasn't been posted.
Right. And we don't have a description. I mean, there could be things in the description that disqualify or somebody might be disinterested in.
Well, I thought, Patty, you now have a description, right?
Right. We've had the description, yes, since March.
Maybe that should come to the next meeting.
Well, that's what I think. I mean, if we are talking about moving forward, that description needs to be discussed and vetted for sure.
And agree upon that. And if we, well, Chris, you kind of, you look like you're.
What I would say is, the language whether, because.
Please.
Because the charter allows the village manager to make that determination, you're right. I mean, that's not going to be done in a vacuum, but ultimately the charter empowers the manager to make those decisions. The weather language seems to me to allow the discretion of the village manager to determine whether or not to go through an internal posting, but it's not mandated, but it's done in the exercise of the manager's discretion. As we all know, most often there is at least some form of internal posting because it's perceived to be a good thing to be inclusive and to give that opportunity to people who've been here. But it's certainly not mandated in that sense. But I think that we could describe it as a best practice. So ultimately, however the manager chooses to move forward with whatever guidance council chooses to give her, you'll work that out as a matter of this situation.
So the fact that it says whether to post internally, externally, or both, but does not give the or not at all, it gives three options.
I think that it allows for the discretion of the manager. I think that that's the intention because of the power that the charter vests in you.
So what you're saying is that if a decision was made to simply appoint the interim chief to the permanent chief position, that could be done?
I believe that it could be.
Well, first of all, let me preface this by saying I do not want to take anything away from what Brian has accomplished. He has done wonderful things down there, but I do feel it is my obligation to voice that I do not feel that that is a fair labor practice. It's because we have other candidates who have expressed interest, at least internally. I just don't feel, and again, Brian is doing a wonderful job, but it's just not a fair labor practice.
I support that we do post it internally as well.
I just wanted to clarify that. I just wanted to make sure that there weren't any questions.
Well, I mean, I think we should take weather out of that sentence moving forward, but again, I agree as well.
Yeah.
Well, if you take weather out, then you have to post it somewhere.
Right.
Yeah.
Which I think we do want to. I mean, I like that we're posting internally.
Yeah, I just, once we do that, I'd like to see that.
So you would like to see the job description in the next packet?
Job description, and then?
And then let's get it posted so we can move forward and with Patty's recommendations, because I just don't want to see us go through a six-month search and come up with an answer that we could have came up with without it.
Right. And Patty, regarding the process, where does that stand? I mean, is that in a draft form that could be brought to council?
I might be able to get it done if Janet and Pat are able to meet. But, I mean, it was similar to the process we had the last time where we had a panel of employees, citizens, council members, but we had expanded it to key stakeholders from, 20 groups something?
Why don't you three decide if you feel comfortable? It's just in introducing it for the first time, I don't see a problem with it coming at the next meeting with the job description. So you decide and maybe put something in, whether the three of you need to work on more or just put it in as it is, as a document for us to consider.
I mean, in general, if we were going to do a broader search, to me, the question is how you do that. Now, in this instance, we may well decide we don't want to do that broader search. And then you're talking more about and sort of the way the community has input.
Well, I mean, if we do any sort of search, I don't see how we can't have the process. If there is a choice of candidates, we've got to have a process for determining which of those candidates is going to be selected.
Right.
Just because it's internal only doesn't negate that. And
no,
I think it actually
I
potentially
agree.
Makes it more difficult. At least certainly more sensitive.
Well, I guess the way it was sounding in terms of stakeholders and all this kind of thing, that seems a lot of people to me. That seems a little
It was to the point where we
well,
were
I mean, I don't know what they're all doing.
How unwieldy
what all those people
right.
are doing. But presumably they're not interviewing. All these people aren't doing interviews.
Well,
if I'm remembering right, one of the things that the larger committee was supposed to do was weed through all the applications.
Right.
So if you decide to not have I mean, if there's three applicants that will not take, we'll just interview them all. So
right.
that's pretty different. So I think that part of that initial process was
right.
that there would be a broad base of people that would get to review all of the initial applications that came in
mm-hmm.
and narrow it down to
five or six or
yeah,
something
and
like that. Yes.
Something like that. So that part of that, that was part of the intent. Then there would be a group that would be
right,
but it wouldn't be 20
group.
People.
Well, what about something more like rather than a complete timeline and going too in-depth, more things like that, bullets about how community involvement could be achieved. And so again, just kind of think about it as sort of bullet points. I think that's plenty. Because talking about that job description is
right.
going to be a substantial amount for a meeting.
And I think also as we consider whether we will have an external search or not, will you know I think I said when we talked on the 20th that our external searches didn't prove a lot in the past, didn't bring us a lot of candidates. So what would be that? Outreach, what kind of outreach could be done
right,
that might bring in a broader
yeah.
Pool of candidates?
We've talked about other external avenues of advertisement, like the Association of Black Police Executives.
Right.
And,
but why don't
others.
You bring that? So
yeah.
so that I, you know, I like what Brian said, just some bullet points of what a public process might look like. Considering the fact that it sounds like we're going to have some sort of a selection process because we will have an internal posting, and then, you know, what those external outreach venues might be.
I was going to say, too, I mean, I know in the past when we were doing, you know, village manager hirings, that sort of thing, we kind of looked at what the practices were in past times, you know, past practices, and I guess I have to say that something we did for village managers some years back when I was on the council before, I thought that we had a fairly good process. So I guess I can just bring that idea, but I don't know if the committee has been looking at any of the earlier processes of the village.
Well, what I patterned the last one after and what this one was going to be patterned after was more along the lines of what I went through, not necessarily the 2 days worth of meetings, but you know the extensive community involvement in the process, as far as representatives from the community being, you know, part of the decision making on which resumes would stay, which ones would no longer be considered, that you know interview process, mm-hmm. all of that.
Okay, so you know what we're doing for the next meeting. Okay, great. Moving on, kind of continuing the same discussion regarding the PD with the policy changes. I think this is going back to the JSTF
yeah,
work.
This was me bringing, I mean, it's the same question as the 365, you know, the policing vision statement or village, whatever it's called. Is, you know, how do we operationalize it? So council agreed to the change in the taser part of the use of force policy, and we supported the CIT training and the implicit bias training that should be done. But then it was just, we all nodded our head, And I know I talked to Chris Conard at another, we were talking about something else. He had called me about something else, and, you know, and I didn't understand what he was saying. So I just thought, let's talk about it here. It seems to me like we need to make it a policy some way, and we need to make it, we need to make it legislation, put it into legislative form.
Right.
So that, you know, so that it has the weight of that. And so that was the only question. That's what this is about, is.
What was decided wasn't exactly that. What we did is there was a motion to affirm and support the recommendations made to council by the JSTF and direct staff and the JSTF to continue to work on the needed next steps. Every one of those recommendations had a next step. I know, for example, that Brian Hausch took, he wasn't totally sold on the taser policy. There were things he wanted to look at the taser policy. I don't know that that chief and the department had fully weighed in on the taser policy. So what I took out of that was that we absolutely supported those, but even the JSTF, what they had to present to us, they recognized that it wasn't ready for legislation. There was still additional work that needed to be done. And we directed them to do that work with the staff.
Well, I mean, I talked to Brian about it afterwards, I believe, about the taser policy. You know, the use of force policy should be looked at in, you know, the whole thing. It's a big piece of work. We don't want, you know, we've made this change around the taser use, and, you know, eventually things may get changed again, but it could be months down the road. And in terms of CIT training, in terms of the taser policy, how you get the department to, you know, I can't think of the word I want. You know, that they start to use, how do you implement? Thank you. Yeah, so, you know, so it's going to take some different training. That's not something JSTF has to figure out. It doesn't seem to me that's something CHIEF, you know, will figure out how to do. The CIT training, I mean, he's already making it happen. They're almost all going to be trained shortly, so that's great. You know, he's taken a first step on the implicit bias. You know, there might be some input there in terms of true implicit bias training is you know, more than a kind of awareness raising of a talk that's going to be given. Nonetheless, I think that's very, very important. So Chief's already taken a first step. So maybe we would want to weigh in on where that the kind of places where, you know, that more in-depth training would take place. But I don't think it's necessary.
So, okay.
I guess I just don't think there's much to do.
I want to ask council and staff a question.
Yeah.
Council members, Patty and Brian, do you all feel like that taser policy that was presented to you, to us, that we're ready to pass that? Supporting that?
In my discussion with Brian and the sergeants, there have been some concerns that have been raised that I think need to be hammered out before it gets passed as a piece of legislation.
So who's hammering it out?
Brian is working with, you were going to talk to Brian Hausch first and then go back to the Justice System Task Force, right?
Yeah, this is probably a good,
can you come up, please?
Yeah, come on up. Well, I should say,
by the time we get to the police report, everybody's gone. It is awkward to be in my position at this moment. At the same time, I want to let everyone know, you know, breathe deep. I'm here. I do feel at this point that some of the mass changes that I'm trying to instill maybe are a little on hold, and I'm more of a caretaker right now. So that changes things a little bit. Do I see us implementing policy changes right now? Absolutely not. Why would we do that? As far as I'm concerned, the whole book needs to be changed. We've got policy in there from when we had three chiefs ago. They took their policy, put it in. The most recent policy that's been implemented, some of the language isn't even changed. It says Montgomery County on it. So that whole thing needs to be rewritten. That would be one of my first things as a project.
And this is the general orders manual?
Yes. I understand the goodness that everyone wants to bring to the department, but it's not statistics. It's not simply doing little things. It's if you want us to take people shopping, I've only got one person on Saturdays when the population doubles to triples. So, you know, we can't chalk tires, take people shopping when we've got 16 calls for services and it's nonstop for 10 hours. Now, some days it's not. But so my focus coming in was to get two officers on at all times. That was my number one thing that I didn't really want to emphasize too much because we've had so much concern about how big of a force we have. We have to have two officers on at all times. It's a must. We won't be a functional department until we do. I worked Sunday alone. I was on patrol myself Sunday, so some of the officers could be off for Easter. Stephanie came in at noon. She was on alone. We were slammed. Traffic accidents, had a domestic. So the reality is this is really more on the street level. And implementing all the language and all these things that we want to achieve greatness in a department is wonderful. But that's not where the changes are going to happen. They're going to happen one interaction at a time from officers following the leaders, seeing what their boss likes, seeing officers come into the chief's office and say to me, hey, let me tell you about last night. And someone who can never get away without writing a ticket was proud to tell me now that they gave a warning because this was a local resident's kid and, you know, and they stayed late to tell me this. That gave me the biggest smile I've had since I've been here because those little interactions are the things that are going to make the difference. Simple things that someone mentioned earlier about care packages for people that move in. Officers do that. We stop by when you see a moving truck. We're the ones out driving around. Hey, are you folks moving in? Here's a chamber guide. Here's a map to the Glen. It would be neat if we could have, you know, maybe some type of assorted gift basket that we would do. But those little things are the things that get noticed and that make a difference. The work 365 is doing is brilliant. You know, everything involving not just trying to not be racist, but really working the complete opposite angle, that's what we're after. But it's still one interaction at a time. It's that traffic crash in front of Tom's. The majority of our parkers, Kate, that park and stay, are residents. They own shops. They sell T-shirts. And I want to implement the... Yeah, and one of the things that has happened, we had sidewalks redone, the signs are up now, and I think that's something that we can start to implement. But when I've got one officer working a Saturday in Yellow Springs, and there's 10,000 people roaming in town and not enough parking, it's a tight fit. But I just wanted to let you guys know, I'm here to help any way I can. If this works out, fantastic. If not, I know I'll have done everything I intended to do, and, you know, I can continue to love it here.
Thank you.
Thanks.
I think that we can put out all the words to you that we want to, but it's going to happen within the department and whoever is at the top, and it's you, thankfully, Absolutely. Is going to make the biggest difference.
Yep. And it is one interaction at a time.
As you say.
You didn't ask me to do this because there was something brilliant about me. It was simply 7 years talking to people, getting to know people, doing community services, those kind of things. It's so much simpler than we're making it.
So I don't want to... That was a wonderful, wonderful speech that you gave, but... Can we get back to the taser policy?
Oh.
Do you want more time to talk about it?
Absolutely.
Okay, so you're going to get back with the Justice System Task Force then on?
Yes, I am.
Okay.
I guess.
On your evening off,
right? You mean on the taser policy?
Well, yes. You know, let me tell you, so much stuff is good, you guys, but let me summarize again. Justice System Task Force. You know, restorative justice, HRC, 365. I've got, And that's wonderful. I want, this is all good stuff. But what I need to do is get officers in uniform, trained the way we want them to be, understand the values of what we want, and I have to fill shifts myself in uniform.
Right.
So, you know, this...
You can only do so much at a time.
This beautiful picture that we have, which we all share, isn't going to just be personally, and I know this might sound a plug for myself, but some world search and a genius is going to come in and make this happen. It's way down beyond that. It's on the street. It's the street level. And I believe we should be able to hire officers. I should be able to pick them, just me. I believe they should start part-time. That way, if it doesn't work out, they're gone. We're doing everything by the book. How's that been working for us?
That's all I'm saying.
Brian, can I ask you a question? Since there's a concern, and you've said a lot of really important stuff.
Yes.
Let me just ask you a basic question, tasers. So when you train our new officer, how is she going to be trained related to tasers?
That's a really good question. It's something that I've toyed with, and I'm having lunch tomorrow with my friend Bill Parsons. He helps write policy for police departments. The biggest criticism that he's given me currently is there's too much there. It's too much in our...
The policy that was presented?
Yeah, and what you have to understand is when you're in it, when I'm confronted in a situation where I might feel that is going to save me, you're not processing page 2, section 3, paragraph 4, you know, wait a minute, I can't pull my taser now. What we'd like to see is a broader understanding of, you know what, I'm not going to pull that, there's a crowd. If I miss, I might hit someone. That's a rule. That's something, to me, that's logical. So there's going to be some specific training from me. But right now, we have to work with what we have, which is the basic OPAVA training.
Okay.
Well, so I guess the question, so I do want to say this. A member of our committee came up with, and we didn't get a chance to discuss it, this idea of, I mean, it sounds like too much. Too much is being, you know, JSTF's doing work, and
right.
People on the committee feel like this urgency, though, you know, some of it's tamping down a little bit about, you know, we need to make these changes, we need to make them quickly. I think 365 has some of that urgent sense of urgency. And it's sounding like that's too much for our department to absorb.
Right.
All of that, some
juggling,
of that.
We're juggling, yeah. But you know, it's funny. When Gavin spoke last council meeting, I appreciated your call before the meeting. You know, it's kind of funny because in reality, nothing's personal, everything's personal. And you know, what you said, in a way, I wanted to jump up and say, that's what I'm trying to do. You know, we could have a great department. We could be trend-setting. We could, you know, really change the face of law enforcement nationally. And I think eventually it will change. It's going to have to. But through the way I operate, it's very simple. It's a very simple method and process. And, you know, you de-escalate. That's your mission. And you show empathy. This person you're with, no matter what their condition, you're letting them know you understand. And then you go from there. That's it. It doesn't take any more than that. And in doing that, as I have for 6.5 years here, that's why you've entrusted me to this position, because that's what I've done. And we have a highly trained group of officers. I've got a great staff. I'm pretty good with understanding who can do what and why they should be doing it. It's all the extra. I mean, we spend so much of our time sending reports to people, printing out data. I can't take somebody grocery shopping if I'm surfing the last 9 years of how many, you know, people we pulled over for this. And I understand the importance of that, but the rush for it is, it's overbearing. And so if the community can do anything for us, it's help. It's help. And that's where I can't figure out anything else to say.
Thanks, Chief.
Thank you.
So
Well, I wanted to say, a member of our committee came up with this idea of notice and comment, and the main reason that idea was brought forward was because that person had taken a drive with a police officer and had discussed with them the taser policy. And they had, that particular police officer had a concern about it. And it, you know, became clear to this member that, you know, we need to be hearing from our police officers, and maybe so that they don't feel under any political pressure or anything, it should be anonymous, that when we bring together a recommendation before it would come to council, it would take another step. And the step, it would get public comment, and it would get, you know,
departmental
comment. Mm-hmm. And it wouldn't be all on Brian that way. You know, because, you know, as good as you are, you might not think of everything, but one of your officers might think of something that you didn't think of, you know,
absolutely,
something like that. So, so we didn't get to that, but that is, you know, something we want to do as a next step. But I'm just a little confused now, and I understand it and I believe it, that there's kind of this sense of getting overwhelmed by all the efforts to change things so quickly that it gets to be too much. So I just don't know, maybe JSTF should only meet every other month or something, because, you know, we're generating these changes. I don't know. So I just don't know. So, but if that's fine. I think that's fine if we don't make it legislation, if it's not ready, but I didn't understand that. But we should,
maybe once you have your final chief position, then you pour on the changes. And right now, continue to steady the ship. And
I think it's important for the task force to keep meeting monthly. To drop mm-hmm. back, you just lose too much.
Right.
But I mean, I think what Brian is saying, and like he's working to just make things work now, yeah, basic things,
right,
and provide the kind of leadership that it's, I think, we want. So, and we're not going to lose all these documents. I mean, once they're written, they're written.
Well, I got confused because it sounded like there was this idea where we're going to bring it all at the end, and that didn't make sense to me. That doesn't make sense to me at all. So, I don't know. Maybe we'll have to kind of rethink how we're going to do the work.
Well, I think, go ahead, Jerry, and then I'll.
Because we were trying to bring recommendations on a regular basis.
And I think what we have to do as council, as you guys bring these recommendations, we have to decide how where we want to put them. And,
yeah,
working with Patty as the manager and so forth. But to me, once a document is done and everybody is satisfied with it, we sign off on it, and then you come up with the implementation plan, okay? But at least the document is there for whoever steps into the position. You know, we don't have to go back and reinvent the wheel. These are the things that are here, whether we give it to a person here or a person that we hire later, the stuff is there.
Well, we ultimately want it to be policy.
Well, that's what I'm saying.
Because we don't want to, you know, 20 years from now, and we have a new chief, and, you know, this stuff, we've worked on all this stuff, and it all be gone out the window.
We've already heard Brian say that one of the first things he would do is rewrite the general orders manual, and that is ultimately where all this stuff needs to go. That is, that's the Bible for the police department. I'm not saying that that council needs to approve that entire manual, but, you know, and maybe there are policies like the taser policy that are overarching that we do set policy on. But the point I was making was, you know, if a new chief is going to rewrite the general orders manual, it seems silly for us to go in and cherry pick little pieces of that to change. But as I said, maybe the taser policy is one we can separate out and say, this is important enough not to wait if we can come to some agreement.
Well, that's the big fear factor because of the incident we have, and that's very understandable. I don't want to put my foot in my mouth, but I don't think changing the policy, the language, would have changed the outcome. And that comes from me.
Right. It's getting that officer under to think about when they would use their taser and why they would use their taser. And
yes,
does it come from a policy?
Right.
Absolutely. And
well, it does and it doesn't. I mean, if you put a pretty restrictive policy, I mean, you know, but the problem is if that's how OPOT is training people, you know. Yeah.
The big thing for us is that we want to eliminate compliance.
Compliance.
Well,
use.
Yeah, it's illegal anyway. Mm-hmm. And
well, and it's used all the time that way. That's standard policing practice, as far as I can know by what I read.
Well, and it's understood in many communities, like Janet, you probably, you know, in Dayton, in many areas, it's not unusual to see officers with their taser out in the light on, and people are used to it. Here, well, we don't want that.
That's what I can say.
The only, Jerry, the only caveat that I would make to what you said was, I don't think that you should pass anything as legislation until there is an implementation plan in place.
Right.
Because you may pass something that is not implementable as written.
Right.
Well, CIT training and implicit bias training, the implementation is, you know.
Agreed.
Very simple.
Right.
You find a good training and you send your people there, and you, as long as you've got the funding, you're good. And you can get them off to the training.
Right.
There's nothing to think about there.
But they're doing it.
I know. But we want it to be policy. Did you want to say something?
I did.
Yeah, okay.
So,
can I
introduce myself again?
Yes.
Katie Hamilton. And I'm on the Justice System Task Force. So, maybe if we, is there a way for us to do sort of a priority timeline type thing? I mean, because you are hiring new officers right now. So, and I met her out in the parking lot, I think. So as they're coming in, you are showing them certain ways that we would like to be policy, that we'd like them to interact. Like, for example, not to put mine on the back burner, but what my recommendation as a police social worker, well, that seems to be down the line, probably, in importance as, you know, we're using tasers now, and we're hiring new officers, and they're doing policies. Is there a way to do that? Because my fear is that I'm going to come in with this recommendation, and everyone here might be, oh, that's a great recommendation, yeah, we like that, and then it's not going to be seen again. So perhaps it's better if we wait to give some of the recommendations, still work on them,
right,
still, you know, fine-tune them, but wait until they make more sense.
Mm-hmm.
You know, once we have something more permanent. I don't know, I just, you know, we have felt this rush. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm like, I have to get this done by now. And I've met with Patty and I've met with Chief Carlson, but perhaps that's not a big rush right now.
Well,
perhaps not everything is a big rush.
Right, and I will say, if I'm not mistaken, Brian, and please correct me if I am, but Mariah filled the last vacant full-time slot.
Correct.
So.
Right. Okay. And then, I mean, you have done the CIT and things
right.
like that, but she's still going to need to know what your policy is for tasers and what
right, which
what
is yeah.
we like in the, you know, the policy of the 365 project.
Right, and Brian is making sure as she is trained and assigned FTOs that she gets that, and I don't want to use the word indoctrination in a bad way,
right.
but that acclimation. Thank you. to Yellow Springs and to what
okay,
is expected
yeah.
here.
I mean, I can't speak for everybody on the Justice System Task Force. I just know that we have said that have felt this sense of urgency, and we have all these subgroups, and it's a lot to do at once. It's way more for Chief Carlson, I'm sure, but you know, we could slow down.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, at least I'll speak for myself. I could slow down.
Slow down.
Volunteering.
But prior choices, I think that's really important.
Prior
you know,
choice.
And we can do a timeline.
Well,
I think council and Chief Carlson and Patty would know.
Right. Where to put the efforts.
Yeah, how
first.
To prioritize. I don't know. It's late.
Well, we got, you know, JSTF was set up with a 2-year timeline.
Right, yeah.
So we got to start there.
Right.
So,
I mean, and
so
you know, the
what
timeline
I would suggest
just got
is JSTF will look at our charge, and we will make a recommendation to council how to maybe mm-hmm. re and you know talk, you know, I don't want to take any more chief's time, but, and I know Patty's really busy and she's hurting right now anyway, but anyway, why don't we look at it first and then try to figure out how to go from there?
Okay, we'll take, Gavin, we'll take one last comment.
Okay, Gavin DeVore-Leonard, I'll try to be brief. I feel like this idea of prioritizing would be great. That's what we're, I think we've been trying to bring that up at different points. I think there's a bunch of good processes going on, but there's sort of like a overall project management challenge. So prioritize, not slow down, I think. With the, we could slow down on some things if we decide how to prioritize. So for instance, we prioritize working on trying to get ready for a hiring process, assuming that that was the way things were moving, and then the priorities change if we don't do a hiring process. So there's, you know, I think there's some project management work that could be done that would be really helpful. And then there are these other things I think flow out of that. So for instance, you know, there's been many points at which there's been concerns raised around capacity. You know, there are management consultants that can come in and help at these points to make sure that there's enough resources to address some of these challenges without overburdening, you know, folks that are on staff or on council. They're just, you know, I talked with a friend of mine who works with a nationally recognized consulting firm that said they could have done, you know, data analysis, needs assessment, community engagement, recruitment process, hiring process for something like $30,000. So just as context, you know, so you can imagine when we heard about the cost of this investigation, it was like, oh my gosh, we could have done like all this stuff that most of us feel like we've been doing part-time jobs trying to figure this out. So anyway, so we could address some of the capacity issues. The other thing about that I want to share, just bring it up now, is I'm not sure what the discipline process is that's going on, but we're obviously down one officer who's on administrative leave, and I think there are a lot of us that are really wondering what the timeline is going to be for that process, and just knowing that we're down a person, and then also concerned that we might be bringing somebody back on the force that wouldn't be a good person. So that's, at some point, be great to have some timeline or process for that so citizens know how to engage on that. Anyway, I'll leave it there, but we'd be happy to engage. This is good stuff to try to figure out.
Okay, sounds great. Thanks, Gavin.
Yeah, I just want to say, Brian, again, I appreciate you being honest and frank. It's not an easy thing to do. But two things I've heard that I think are really important, because clearly everybody's coming at Brian from every different direction, and I understand, you know, why that's happened. But this prioritizing thing I think is huge, can make a big difference. And the other piece, and it kind of is, I think, what Gavin was getting at with project management, is trying to figure out, you know, how these groups all sort of collaborate and organize. And because I know Brian will not say no to anyone that wants to meet with him, and he will go to every event. And that's why I was kind of saying spread the wealth, you know, get those other guys out there and women. But if we could figure out those two things, I think that would take some stress off of Brian, because clearly he's doing a great job, and that's the message I've heard overall. So
mm-hmm. I think that's great.
I was going to say, since Gavin brought up the question of the disciplinary process, can we get an update on the time frames where things are with that?
There's a process ongoing, and there's rights that have to be adhered to.
So how, do you have any idea of the timeline? Sorry, that's out of line. What does that mean, soon?
There's a process that has to play out. I really can't get any more details than that.
So what's the appropriate way for citizens to, is it just like voice concerns here and in general comment, or how should people?
I'd say letters. I'd say letters maybe would be a good idea.
Okay.
The council? Yes, sure. Thanks. Okay, moving on to the housing needs assessment. I think that was something that Marianne and
yes.
Patty were working on. Probably not Patty
well,
so much.
Yeah, with talk. Denise, Marianne can, obviously, yeah. They worked on it last week while
yeah.
I was
okay.
incapacitated.
So I met with Denise Swinger, our planner, and Emily Seibel from Home Inc. We had a good meeting in looking at, we looked at the village just at the places that can be built out and discussed the different places in town. That came out of a concern of Denise's, who realize that if all the places could be built, that could be built out, would be built out, we'd be well over 5,000 people. So clearly, that's a background concern. But I don't, we also agreed that it's not the primary concern at this time, but it is a background concern. So I have been studying what's involved in a housing needs assessment. I reviewed one that is from a community somewhat similar to Yellow Springs. I've made a list of the kind of things that I think we might want in a housing needs assessment, and I also talked to Sandy Wiggins, who's working at, with the Antioch on the Antioch development. I talked to him to find out what kind of information Antioch might be willing to share with us from the studies they've done. I don't have that information yet. To get an update on their project. They apparently will hope to be coming this summer with a PUD proposal to Planning Commission for a 34-unit co-housing development. I also asked him, well, I asked him about market studies, the kind of study they did, which was called a market position analysis. A little bit different than what we want to do, but maybe it would have some of the same characteristics. Same characteristics in that I think, at least for myself, we're interested in looking into the future as our community, what kind of populations might we want to be attracting, as well as the populations that we currently know need housing. I also asked Sandy what we might expect to pay for a housing needs assessment. He thought probably between $20,000 to $40,000. Now, I have some more research to do, and I plan on talking with Bowen, I forget the second word, an organization in Columbus. Patrick Bowen does housing needs assessments, and Emily has worked with him. Mm-hmm. So I would think that by the next council meeting, we could come back at least with something for council to look at that would say, these are the things we're thinking we would want to have in a housing needs assessment, mm-hmm. and get input from council regarding that. And then probably do an RFP.
Okay, sounds good. Yeah, I don't want to get caught up. I think the community got caught up when back in the 80s about the fear of what might be, and
we're
that's
gonna
why
be 15,000
in the position we're in right now of not having enough housing.
In the 60s, actually.
Pardon, was it?
In the 60s.
Yeah. Okay, sounds great.
Yeah,
thanks.
I remember.
Thanks, Marianne. The next item is the retreat agenda, and I messed around with that a lot. And what did I do with it? Where is it? Here. Oh, thank you. So let's see. We added some things at the last meeting, and one of the things you asked to have added, Judith, was an update on the budget. Melissa is actually going to be presenting her 2018 budget, right?
Well, the tax budget.
The tax budget in July. So she'll be coming to council in June with some pretty firm financial information. So it seemed a little, it's going to be very difficult for her to get information together for the retreat. So it seemed like that's something that we're going to get an update on relatively soon after the retreat. So I removed that from the agenda. Let's see. There were some questions, and I think Marianne may have asked this conflict of interest procedure clarification. And it's something that Chris was going to talk about also, so I gave that a half an hour. I think that Marianne had mentioned that. I think that council staff handling of citizen inquiries and information requests, part of that's public information requests, then part of that is just, you know, how we share information with citizens to make sure we're being as open and transparent as we can, how we respond to questions and concerns presented at council. We've talked about that before, and want to make sure we're on the same page there. get an update on the leadership training and staff development work that that's going on or that that had started. And then after, excuse me, after a break at 2:45, then we'll go into executive session to consider the employment or compensation of a public employee. And then at 3:30, it'll be council only. So I don't know how council feels if we...
And who will be in the executive session from 3 to 3:30?
Patty and Chris.
Okay.
And is anybody else, Chris? Is anyone else from Coolidge Wall coming?
I think Jessica will probably be there.
Okay.
Karen, what's the preparatory documents, this stuff around? I mean, how do we prepare for these discussions?
I don't know. I mean, I was gonna prepare. I mean, obviously,
I don't know how to prepare for this.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, the goals document, the project management piece. I see that as being in a little bit in staff's hands.
I actually have prepared some draft documents for that already.
The conflict of interest procedure, that's something that Chris is going to lead. I mean, the goals timeline is probably the only one that's really potentially material intensive. I don't know that it really is. I mean, it's basically bringing the goals with us and having a calendar and really talking realistically about what needs to be done and how we can get it done and everything.
What's the relationship with that and the project management piece?
It's probably pretty tightly connected.
I would agree.
And so maybe those will end up being intermixed. I don't know. You know, maybe.
So, Patty, you're going to have some documents for us ahead of time.
Yeah, one of the things that council asked me to try to think about was a process for when we hire consultants and how to make sure that they stay on track and that kind of thing. And so I just have some ideas about that.
Okay. Yeah, I wasn't quite sure what that was about.
I mean,
I was seeing commissions and stuff, and I was trying to think about how that's related to the commissions.
I wonder if we should potentially put that first and then talk about goals.
Consultant?
No, the project management piece.
Oh.
Yeah, maybe.
I mean... The other way to think about it is, you know, by working through the goals, we'll have examples in mind.
True.
To think about the project management piece. I think the agenda looks great. Mm-hmm. And actually, I'd like to tackle the goals early in the morning.
When we're fresh. Fresh.
Because I think it's so critical. I mean, it's all important. But.
So Judy, B105, is that the one on the first floor as soon as you come in the door?
And to your left, yes.
To your left, okay, good. Okay. Will you have flip charts and maybe have those kinds of tools, please?
Mm-hmm.
Pens. Mm-hmm. And maybe even bring some pens that won't destroy their whiteboards because they've got actually a great whiteboard system.
Got it.
I don't know if we'll use it. We typically don't, but it's nice to have them. Okay, so we're good. We're good with that. Let's see. So I guess that's really it. So now we're no new business. We're moving on to the manager's report.
The glass farm easement was noticeably not in the packet tonight. That's because the easement is being redrawn. If council remembers, there were some concerns about how to bring that in and kind of push it gently to the southwest along the edge of the creek there. So Marianne and I and Jerry met with Krista and Michelle, and Krista Buchan also joined us. And what we decided was that the 60-foot wide access corridor on the north end of the property, we're going to open that up to 100 feet. That will give plenty of room to have a nice wide street with parking on one side of it, end up with a buffer along the north end so that the homes are shaded are screened. And the easement will then slant slowly south along the wetland area and the creek to ensure that the conservation easement has enough room to expand. The retention pond has enough room to expand if necessary, but it still gives the maximum amount of space left for development. Also, if you remember when Ken LeBlanc was here, he couldn't get his rain garden pictures up. So those are included in the packet so that you have samples of rain gardens. That's what he was trying to talk about during the process when he was delivering his report. But I know that there was a question, about a potential non-motorized bike path along the southern boundary there coming out onto King Street, and that was something we actually discussed. Marianne actually said, what about moving the access to the southern end? But we would have to create a bridge, et cetera. The grant allows for non-improved accesses. So we can potentially put a path there with gravel or mulch, chipped mulch or something like that along there. That we don't need to an allowance in the actual easement for that, because that's already permitted under the grant. You just can't make it asphalt or concrete.
So that there doesn't have to be language that carries over into the easement for that?
No, it's allowed under the grant. And it's actually, if you look at Ken's picture, it's hard to see, but he actually left a little purple lane along that south border because that's what that is.
Okay.
So the TLT easement update is, this comes out of the Arnovitz property and the property that Community Solutions purchased during the auction. That they are interested in putting a permanent easement on approximately 80 acres of that. So they're still working with Tecumseh Land Trust on that. And Krista and I are in contact about that. Under the agreement that we had with TLT, the village would provide 58% of that, whatever that easement ends up being. And if you look at my math there, that comes out to about $64,960 if that comes to fruition.
So the other money would stay in the green space fund?
The other money would stay in the green space fund for now, yes.
And then you referenced Nature Conservancy.
Krista believes that we could eventually get all of that back from the Nature Conservancy, in which case it would go right back into the green space fund.
Right.
Yes, I mean, I think we need to take advantage of any of those opportunities.
That's awesome.
But this is if we got the grant, right?
Yes, you still have to apply. It's still a competitive grant, but they have a lot of funding right now, so the chances are good.
Great. Okay.
The hike bike trail, Green County Parks and Trails has gotten a lot of complaints about the brush that's growing close to the bike path just south of Dayton Street, or I'm sorry, Xenia Avenue there, behind Bentino's and the fire department on the east side of the bike path. So we walked it, Chris Bell Bednar, myself, and another gentleman from the park district, Nick Budis, Jason Hamby, and I, we all walked it together. We came up with a plan. The unfortunate part of the plan is that we have got to use some glyphosate because it's honeysuckle and nothing else kills it. So the hope is to work in conjunction with Glen Helen volunteers, and we would have it cut back and they would immediately follow us painting the stumps using the minimum amount necessary to kill that honeysuckle back. That it would clear that whole thing out there for safety, because a lot of it's growing out into the path, and it's the people are complaining that if they're riding their bike along that edge, they're getting hit. So
is the brush going to be removed
The brush is going to be removed immediately by ArborCare. They would just chip it up and take it away.
There's a situation north on the bike trail in the Clark County area where somebody's gone through and just cut all of the honeysuckle. They've left it along both sides. It's hanging on to the bike trail. It's a very dangerous situation,
yeah.
So I wouldn't want that to happen.
No, our plan is to have ArborCare do the cutting, and they'll just throw it right right into the chipper and take it off, and then the volunteers would come along. Nick is trying to organize his volunteers, and whenever they're available, we'll do it. We'll make sure it gets publicized out there on Facebook, on the website. We'll get it in the news. Unfortunately, it's the only way to get rid of honeysuckle.
Can you explain a little bit more about the closure that you referenced?
Well, we just, to make it safe while the work is going on, that section will be closed to traffic, through traffic on that. But the good part is you can go up through the parking lot and pick it right back up on the north side of.
Okay.
Because
so we'll just put out some signs.
We'll just put out some signs and say, hey, go up this way and cut back around, because it's, you know, we have to close it while we're doing this work. It's just not safe. The next to the last thing that I have is, as council knows, we're working towards all organic products on village properties, and we did have that training session with Beyond Pesticides. They did our test, soil tests. We're ready now to do our test plot. It's out at Gaunt Park on part of the Ultimate Frisbee Field. It's already marked off if you want to see where it is. The things that will be put on here are things like dried molasses and things like that, 100% safe organic compounds that are to improve the nutrients in the soil, not to kill anything per se, but the way you do this is you improve the soil, the health of the soil, and it chokes out the weeds. The grass chokes out the weeds. That's how this works. So this will be happening. Jason is working with Steve Parr to put these things down appropriately, and so that's what's going on there. If anyone has any questions, please feel free to call either myself or Jason Hamby or Nadi Malarkey, who is on the Environmental Commission and is the Environmental Commission liaison for this project. She's going to be putting out some informational materials as well on that. And the last thing I would like to say is the surgery went well. I'm going to be in this thing for another 5 weeks, but I appreciate all those who gave me the well wishes, and to the person who was kind enough to give me that wonderful, wonderful chicken pot pie from Current Cuisine. God love you. That thing is so good. I'm still eating on that, and you know who you are, so thank you very much.
And Patty, I wanted to make one more comment. Happy birthday this Wednesday.
Oh, thank you very much.
Oh, wow. Yay.
Great. Yes, I'm in Aries. That explains a lot.
Chief.
The Yellow Springs Police Department consists of dedicated dispatchers and peace officers. We are public servants sworn to protect and serve the community. We will treat every person we encounter with dignity. We will seek peaceful resolutions to each situation, using force only as an absolute last resort. We will keep the safety of the community in mind at all times. I think that should go on our wall.
Mm-hmm. I like that.
Simple police term. The department's excited to introduce our newest officer to the team, Ms. Mariah England. She'll begin her training with Field Training Officer Jeff Beam on April 26th. I was very impressed with Mariah. She really liked the philosophy that Yellow Springs is presenting, and I think she will be a long-term member of the Yellow Springs Police Department.
Right, and I just want to second that, Brian. I was also very impressed with her when I spoke to her. She's in a caregiver position right now. And I think that's taught her a lot of patience and understanding, and mm-hmm. I think that she's going to be a good fit.
So this is her first assignment as an officer?
Yes, one of her patients came tonight.
Okay.
Aww.
Police Department has scheduled our first implicit bias training session for May 11th with bias recognition diversity specialist Mr. Keen Tony of Tony Policing Consulting.com. It's kind of a new thing, so we're getting our feet wet a little bit, but it's a start.
It's good.
And he is one of the best. that was recommended. Officers, this Wednesday, I'll be joining the Antioch students for lunch on campus, followed by a tour. I was able to get three commitments from officers, myself, Sergeant Watson will be there, Luciana Leaf, and Sergeant Knapp. One thing to mention, Brian, to your point about liking to see officers at functions and so forth, without saying it in any other way, they have to be paid. It's difficult. Mm-hmm. Work in different shifts, and so, you know, we use what we can. The department is sending two officers to be CI trained the third week of April. That's myself and Sergeant Watson. Both of us lack that training, so that'll be good. We're looking forward to that. It's the whole week. Good news at the high school, preliminary report from our seatbelt challenge suggests that Yellow Springs High School scored a 90% this year for the annual seatbelt challenge. That's good stuff compared to being coming in last in Greene County last year.
Yeah, what was it, like 70s or something?
Yeah, it was
pretty low.
Yeah.
We're also seeking more student volunteers who'd be interested in walking with officers to share experiences of life in Yellow Springs. Please contact me, 767-7206. Third week of May is when we'll start the dialogue on that, and then hopefully once we get it put together, we'll start seeing officers walking with residents at all shifts.
Great.
Great.
Any questions?
I was just going to make, do we have this on the website?
What?
About the last point? Because I was just thinking we should make a Facebook post about it as well.
I don't know, but I can certainly put it up there if you would please remind me tomorrow.
I will, and I haven't looked at it, but someone emailed me, it was a couple weeks ago, and said that the former police chief's picture is still on there, so maybe.
Well, there are two different Facebook, and this is a question that keeps coming up, so maybe I should address it. There are two different Facebook pages. There is a police department Facebook page, and there is a village Facebook page. And unfortunately, when Chief Dave Hale created the police department Facebook page, he linked it to his personal page, and the only way to get it down is to take his personal page down, and he's not willing to do that.
I see.
So
can we deactivate it?
I've asked him to do that, and he says Facebook is telling him that there isn't a way. So if someone has a way to do that, because I need to deactivate my walk page. So
maybe you could just change.
Brian,
can't you just change
help
the pictures? Like,
yeah,
put
we can deactivate
some nice pictures
it.
Up.
Okay. Now we don't. Yeah. I mean, I think the thing is we don't probably don't want the page.
Right.
So just, I mean, I understand you'd want your picture, but we just don't want the page.
Yeah.
Well,
it's not. I mean, it's not so much picture of me as.
Yeah, what the goal is actually then is to just have one Facebook page that, you know, all departments can use.
Mm-hmm.
So,
mm-hmm.
Yeah. All right, then I'll.
But,
Brian,
if you remind me tomorrow, we'll get that up on the village Facebook page.
Okay, well, of course, I just.
Is it Judy?
Yeah, Judy.
It's me. The only thing to note is that we are almost out of lights, and we're actually going in right now to May, which is when we were going to distribute those to every kid in the school system, but we don't have very many at this point, so that would require another commitment on the part of council if, in fact, you still want to do that. We've been distributing them like crazy, but not through the school system. So that's just...
Are they the lights that are so hard to turn on?
No.
Oh, these are...
Those were the walking lights.
Okay.
Which, yeah.
Oh, these are bike lights.
Yeah, these
the
are
bike
the bike lights.
Okay.
Well, I feel like we should make a decision about this now because there are all these events in May for Bike Month.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, there's talk now about building those around bike lights and safety. I certainly support it.
How much money are we talking about, Judy?
Oh, close to $700.
Second.
Yep. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay.
So, Judy, how soon can we get more lights?
They're laborious to order, but I'll get right on it. You got to go a couple boxes at a time. It's very weird, but I'll just get on it. And
so, by May 10th?
Yep. Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. Because that's when I know the high school, middle school, and elementary school wanted to promote that. So, thanks.
Okay, moving on to board and commission reports. We'll start with Jerry with Planning Commission and Finance Committee.
Planning,
We had two actions that we took that should be coming to the board.
May 1st? No, May 15th.
No, May 15th.
Okay.
And we're still going to be diving into the name of that document.
The comprehensive land use plan. And in fact, Denise has promised no more text amendments.
Right.
So that planning commission can focus on the comprehensive land use plan. At least she's going to hold off until fall, so they can.
Are these two? So I assume that you're talking about ordinance 2017-07 and 06. What are those the two new ones that are coming, and are they going to be as innocuous as the one we passed today, or is this going to be more complicated?
No, this is the same legislation that got pulled.
Okay, so it sounds to me like these are actually being pulled again because it's going back to Planning Commission, right?
Then they meet May 8th, so I have no idea whether Denise feels like that can move that quickly. But I will also say that if, you know, given Judith's comments, those won't be the same ordinances. They won't be the same ordinances if they're substantially changed. So,
but I just.
My understanding from Matt is that he wanted to bring it back to Planning Commission, then they're going to have to run it past
okay,
legal.
Well,
so
yeah,
probably he's not going to be ready
right,
in the second meeting in May.
Yeah, because he wasn't at the meeting, so. The last meeting. So.
Oh, wasn't he?
No.
So are there two other text amendments? That's what I'm confused about.
No, these are the same two. That
okay. So there are. Okay. Brian?
Arts and Culture Commission did not meet, and we heard from the Economic Sustainability Commission, so I think we're up to date on mine.
Okay. Judith?
Well, Justice System Task Force wanted to bring a couple recommendations. One was about the mayor's court and using the mayor's court whenever possible. And I think we could probably bring that one. It's an encouragement to use the mayor's court more. That's basically what it is. The other one is on the social worker. And I'm kind of feeling like, yeah, why don't we hold off on that one for the moment? And the other one was the 365 statement, which we already talked about. So people are, working hard. So we'll have to try to rearrange our focus maybe a little bit and get our look at priorities. Energy Board is having a meeting tomorrow with, what's the name of that group?
Empower.
And it's about, they want to think about a program that the village could sponsor in some way that would help with energy efficiency of our and reduce utility costs for our citizens. So they're meeting with them again a second time. And library, I think we got a very thorough report in the Library Commission. I was not able to go to the last meeting, so I have nothing to say about the library.
It was actually canceled the last.
Oh, was it canceled? Mm-hmm. Okay. That's it.
Okay, Mary Ann.
Okay, the mediation program has not met. I have not met with Steve Kahn with the school board, but I think that would be important to do, so I'll set up a meeting with him shortly. The Human Relations Commission did meet. Aaron Sari came, and one of the things that we talked about was what's involved in being a sanctuary village. Both, he gave some historical background. He talked about that churches are really the only place, if someone is being offered sanctuary, churches are the only place, apparently, that police do not go. And he talked about issues involving that. He's going to get in touch with, he's going to provide some more information. In fact, he did send some information about, that came from the Presbyterian Church about that. We had two requests for grants. One about the parkour, is that how you say it? Parkour project, which is happening
Of this Saturday.
This Saturday. The other is about the Bulldog Boogie, an all-school dance that would include parents as well as students from the Antioch School. And let's see. Those were the main things that we discussed. And the chief came and talked. And also the issue of the social worker was discussed at HRC.
And the housing was too, wasn't it? Was that benefit? Yeah, housing for police officers.
No, that wasn't discussed at HRC. That came from Emily Seibel. Okay. Let's see. The Environmental Commission is meeting this week. We haven't met since our last retreat in last month. The Beaver Management Task Force has not met, but we have been consulting with Jason. The culvert, the flow device near the King Street culvert, apparently silt has been building up. Mm-hmm. And as far as I know, it's not really creating a problem yet, and I don't think Jason thinks he knows what the problem is, but I don't think anything has been done yet.
I know they worked on it one day before I left, but I don't know if they did anything.
Yeah, I don't think any changes have actually been made. I'm done.
Okay. Green County Regional Planning, I've got a meeting tomorrow. There really isn't much on the agenda. I was glad that Ken did that report, and I want to thank him again for doing that as part of our contract or our member services on the glass farm. But it's just good to know that he knows the community. And Steve Anderson, was it Steve Anderson, I think, who was his predecessor, was also very involved in Yellow Springs. So it's good that continuity is happening. Miami Valley Regional Planning Commission, we didn't have a meeting this month, but we do have our annual meeting tomorrow night, right? No, Wednesday night. So I'm looking forward to that. And Chamber, we've got a meeting on this Thursday. It's a lunch and learn about Chamber benefits. So lunch is provided by the Southern Ohio Chamber Alliance. So if you're interested in learning about Chamber membership, please come to that meeting. And then May 18th, and this is one that I particularly like council members to note, we have a business after hours at DMS Inc., and that's Thursday, May 18th from 5:30 to 7:30, and everybody's invited to that. They'll do facility tours and talk about the work that they do there, so that'll be fun. And then we're also doing a Dayton Dragons game on May 30th. And we've got some fun projects. I don't want to talk about them yet because they're not done. But we've got some fun projects happening over at the train station. So that will enhance things over there. So we're excited. I think that's it. Looking at agenda planning, April 24th, big day. We're having our retreat. May 1st agenda, Judy, that first ordinance, first of all, it's a second reading, and the 2017-9 is the one about that we just had the first reading of.
Right.
Right, because the numbers all changed, so yeah.
So are we going to have the conservation easement?
It depends on whether we get the new attachment from the surveyor.
Okay. So, but we'll definitely have the second reading of 2017-09.
If we get the survey, yes.
No, it's 2017-09 is the lawn.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Is the landscaping.
Okay.
We will have U.S. Bank. We'll have a discussion on U.S. Bank. Melissa will be here. I'll have the copy of the letter that we received in the packet. We're going to have the chief description.
Hiring process document.
And a brief hiring process document.
You may get a resolution agreeing to the annexation.
I was wondering. So we have the Gustafson annexation that there was a step that needed to happen that didn't happen in time for this meeting. I know that they are anxious, so you know, however quickly we can move on that, I want to be able to do that. So, and then we've got the big one really is the Design 9 final community fiber report. Mm. And then on the 15th, these...
On the first, there's still a recommendation on the mayor's court.
Oh, okay.
And I mean, I'm wondering about the social work recommendation, even if there's no action taken immediately, because I know Duke's been involved in that discussion, and so has Patty. So I don't know how you guys feel about it.
I haven't had a chance to read the additional information that Kate sent to me yet. I mean, I think it's a great
idea.
I mean,
it's no rush, but it's just, yeah.
I mean, I think it's...
There's a kind of need, it sounds like, that it's some...
I think it's a great idea, I just want to read what Kate sent.
And I guess what I would...
Wait till the 15th.
Yeah, anyway, I guess what I would say about that is that, because I think it's a great idea too, but hearing Chief talk about, and us knowing our budget, knowing our resources, you know, I'm hoping that you're exploring how other agencies and things could potentially work to provide that kind of a service, as opposed to potentially us hiring.
Kate's done a lot of that research, yeah.
Okay, great.
Yeah, there's a lot of creative ways to...
Great, terrific.
Patty's pretty creative about that stuff too, so let's go back.
We'll figure it out.
So it looks like we're taking off these first two ordinances, and could they possibly be renumbered, Judy?
They will, yeah, they will have to be renumbered.
Okay, so we'll take those two off completely on May 15th. And chances are they won't be coming back then. But what's this next one? What's the 707 repealing section 1280? I'm very confused.
Just take that, that's a duplicate.
Okay.
That goes off as well.
Okay. Then we have, we will have Paul Newman Jr., who is the Greene County Economic Development Director. He will be at the May 15th meeting with this resolution related to the enterprise zone agreement for Dayton Mailing Services. And we do have on that one, we have something for Gustafson. We'll just keep that as a placeholder. If it is ready for the first, we'll bring it there. HRC end of year report and Environmental Commission end of year report. Okay.
That's it.
Sounds like we're busy. Mm-hmm. Okay. Motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Somebody's